Shalom, ma shalom cha, ma shalom meh. My name is Kahan Tazadah. Today, I'm going to ask you to pay specific attention to everything that's stated in this documentary. What is a secure party creditor and why it's more important that you become a secure party creditor more than ever before. Everything that I state in this video is didactic, so pay specific attention. What is a secure party creditor? Why is it important for you to become one? Does this stuff really work? How can I become a secure party creditor? These questions and more will be answered. But I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not subscribed to my YouTube channel, the program Enlightener on YouTube, do so now. And be sure to jot down my website, www.truedisciplesofchrist.org/shop. Become a secure party creditor now. What do you mean? Secure creditor is one that's actually filed the necessary paperwork to put certain entities on notice to let them know that he's no longer operating under a corporate ward status. An aggrieved man that's decided to stand up for oneself, that's taken control of that primary contract, which was the live record of birth, which was actually then transferred into a birth certificate. He's actually regained the power of attorney by doing a revocation of power of attorney over his or her life. And thus, with various other documentations, has essentially become a secured party creditor and has actually taken control of his estate. Pay particularly attention to the testimonies in this video as you will learn much about the secured party creditor redemption process, which you could actually become by visiting the website that you saw on the screen previously, www.truedisciplesofchrist.org/shop. Sister, you're about to see in the first video, I assisted with a traffic situation.
Hello, world. I am ready to meet Tazadok today, a fella I met off, well, seen on YouTube, and loved his work that he did for the Black community. I feel that he is a very intellectual person who caters to us and actually cares about us. So I'm looking forward to this meeting. I'm super excited. He wants me to make a video about my court experience where I was basically brutalized.
So it's Tazadok. What I'm about to do now is actually let you get a witness of someone that's actually been dealing with the de facto court systems and the police, and she's gonna come sit down in just a second and entertain you. And I'm gonna actually give her some interrogatories and possibly give her the proper direction.
Yes.
So I'm gonna say your name. So it's Tazadok and
Larice,
and yeah, things are a little funny to her, but so I'm just gonna ask her some questions about one of her like recent encounters with constables on patrol and the de facto court system. So I guess, you know, she got pulled over. Matter of fact, I'll let her tell you. But for the record, I just want to put this out here, give you my little mantra. This is not legal advice. We do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel. And then please be advised. Everything in this video and anything forthcoming is just for informational, entertainment, and educational purposes only. So if you use any of this and you fall flat on your face, then you actually assume all responsibility for your actions. So with that being said, can you just give us like a brief synopsis about
how you actually got pulled over and how you actually stood in court.
Okay, so basically, yes, I got pulled over for speeding.
Can you just walk up? I just need to talk
louder.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, I'm a soft speaker. So I got pulled over for speeding, and that initially got me a ticket for driving on suspended as well, because I didn't know my license was suspended at the time. So I ended up with two tickets, one for speeding reckless, 20 miles over the speed limit, and driving on suspended.
Now, let me ask you this. Let me just interject for a second. Like, because in places like New Jersey, like if you're going 20 miles over,
mm-hmm.
they automatically take you to jail. They didn't try and take you to jail or anything?
No.
Oh. All right. Go ahead.
Jail. So, get my ticket, I sign it, and I go. Well, actually, I was going to refuse to sign it, but the officer told me, if I didn't sign it, then he would take me to jail, and my day would be actually pretty longer than it would be just for me signing.
So let me ask you this now, because he told, really, that, you know what extortion is?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Extortion is, say, if you tell me to do something, and if I say I'm not going to do it, then you're going to tell me that you're going to do something to me, like take me to jail.
Mm-hmm.
That's extortion,
mm-hmm.
because I'm actually being coerced into that.
Okay.
So, you had the option of, like, signing, but, you know, at least stating, well, I'm signing under protest and duress. And then, if you sign, you should have actually reserved your rights, UCC 1-308, all rights reserved, UCC 1-308. So, you know, something to keep in mind is that if he tells you, if you don't sign this, I'm going to take you to jail. Okay, I'm going to sign, but I'm doing so under protest and duress, because it's not your will. It's like you're being compelled to sign it. You understand?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right.
So I go to my first court date, I guess, which is the arraignment. And, you know, I've been watching a couple of YouTube videos to get me prepared, because I didn't want to get stuck with a fine or points on my ticket for actually my license being suspended for another reason, which maybe we'll talk about that later. But it got suspended for a reason that I felt was unfair and unjust to me. Basically, I had evidence to prove that I was innocent in the first place, and the judge threw it out and said that my letter from my insurance company basically was a fraudulent letter, and they dismissed it, and I got found guilty. And when I got found guilty, I failed to pay those fines, and that's how my license ended up getting suspended in the first place. So I get to court, and I already have a plan to try to beat it. I use my birth certificate, and...
Can I just interject for a second? Because I just want to get clarity. So the insurance company responded, and they found that you not guilty for what? Like,
I was involved in a 3-car accident.
Okay.
And
and you was cleared of that by your insurance company?
Yes, I was cleared of that by my insurance company. But like I said, when I took the letter to court, they dismissed it as a fraudulent letter, and that is what actually found me guilty, because I had no other evidence to produce. And so I go to court for driving on suspended and the speeding ticket, and the judge, he calls my name, and I tell him that basically, yes, Nerese is here, but I refuse to say that my last name was Malden. I told him that that was my family name, and that's all, the only thing that I go by is my first name, nothing more, nothing less. And as I was walking towards the judge, because I haven't even gotten a chance to get in front of him yet, this is all while I'm walking towards him. And I get to the part where they usually have the gates that you're supposed to enter, but they didn't have that. They just had a straight bench.
Right.
And I remember a guy on a video saying, you know, you don't want to go through that, because you're basically, I guess, entering there. So I hesitated, I stopped, and I didn't want to walk any further, but they kept calling me, and I was like, do you want me to go through here? And he said yes, and I walked through. And at that moment, I felt like I already messed up because I entered the ship. And so the judge said, "Are you Nerys Mowden?" Should I have said my last name?
No, you should. The way I would have answered that is I could be referred to as that. Or I'm here as intervener. But I'm not the name. And it, yeah. You know, but, I mean, he probably would have been something like, well, if that's not you, then who are you?
Yeah, so yeah. Basically I was like, I am Nerys, but that's all I go by. Nothing more, nothing less. And he said, well, if this is not you, then why did you come to court? And then I said, I am the administrator to this account, and this is the person that you're looking for. And I attempted to give my birth certificate to the deputy who was standing to my left, and she refused to take it. So I asked the judge, I was like, "Judge, are you not going to take this from me?" And he stated no, and he...
Because some people that's watching at home or on YouTube, they might understand why. Why is it that you was actually giving them the birth certificate? Like, could you just elaborate on that?
Well, I'm not too familiar about the whole thing, but I do know that my birth certificate is capitalized because it is a corporation.
Right.
And so I've just kind of seen some YouTube videos on it, so I figured it might help me out in court.
So, yeah. I mean, so briefly, I mean, basically, by presenting a birth certificate... Because it's really not you, the living soul that's being called in court, is your corporate construct, the fiction, the corporation, the straw man, whatever you want to call it. So when he calls you and trying to get you to respond to the name, he's trying to create joinder. And thereby, if you answer to the name, now you're standing in place of the fiction. So if there's a fine that needs to be paid, the straw man is not obligated to pay it. The straw man can't pay a fine. You're going to have to do it. A straw man only exists on paper, right? So if you don't pay the fine, then they'll try and throw you in the box. So that's why they try and create joinder and get you to answer to the name. So once they've established that, you know, there's supposed to be three procedures to actually going into court. It should be status. You know, you establish status. Like, what is the status of the judge? Like, what's your status? Are you a competent ward of the state? Are you a 14th Amendment citizen? Or are you a man or a woman, a free man or a woman on the land? Then once status is established, you move on to jurisdiction. Does the court have jurisdiction over the subject matter? Does the court have, you know, personal jurisdiction? If they don't have jurisdiction, they can't proceed. The case is supposed to stop right there until they have jurisdiction. So... one way to challenge jurisdiction is to require that they produce a delegation of authority order, which actually comes from a higher court, because these are inferior courts. So if they don't have that delegation of authority order, they don't have jurisdiction, so I'm leaving. So when there's someone here with a verified claim against me, that means someone's bringing a claim against me under oath or affirmation. That means that that person had to literally swear or affirm that what they're claiming that I did is absolutely true. If there's no verified claim, well, I'm going to be leaving now, you know? So, and the third is adjudication. That's what they're supposed to do. That means he starts asking, well, you're being charged with such and such. How do you plead? But the typical courts, these color law courts, they skip the first two procedures like status and jurisdiction, and they jump right into adjudicating. Are you such and such? Well, how do you plead?
Right.
And right there, that's how we get chopped up.
Yes.
But it kind of means you lose your thoughts. So, I mean, continue.
No, it's okay. So, back to that, I had the birth certificate, and I, like I said, attempted to hand it to the judge and the deputy sheriff.
I don't even like calling them judges, because chances are you was dealing with a magistrate. Mm-hmm. Like, most of them are magistrate, and, you know, they refer to themselves as judges.
Mm-hmm.
But... me, I have a tendency, if the magistrate name is Bob, I will just say, no, Bob, yes, Bob, you know, something like that. Because I bring him down to my level, because he don't have authority over you. If you grant them authority over you, then that is jurisdiction.
Okay.
Because remember, we're all equal under the law. Continue.
That's good. So
that's a maxim of law. Like, we're all equal under the law. And truly, in their public servant status, like, we, if we are a man or if we are a woman in our proper status, then we are the authority because we put them in office. But we didn't put them in office to, like, afflict us with commerce, because that's what they're doing. Like, mostly all of our problems are deriving from the affliction of commerce, whether it's relationships and so on and so forth. It all goes back to the affliction of commerce. They put this tremendous commercial burden on us and push people in positions where they can't pay, and they make their lives difficult. Then you just start stressing out from, you know, other perspectives.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, so that didn't work. They didn't accept the birth certificate. So immediately after that, the judge leaned over and he stated to me, he was like, look, I'm not going to play any games with you. You know what you did, and you're going to basically take care of what you got to take care of. And I stated to the judge that, you know, I'm not here to play any games. I'm basically here to, like, protect myself, because that's what I have to do. And at that very moment when I, after the birth certificate incident, there were about 10 to 11 deputies to the right. And out of those deputies, five of them came toward me when I stressed the fact of pulling my birth certificate out. Now, mind you, I'm in court, you know, I'm very professional. I was dressed very professional. I spoke very professional. I had heels on. And so I guess that really just didn't matter. But the officers came at me in a very aggressive way. So I basically stepped to the left and put my right hand towards them and was like, you know, fall back, basically. They never touched me. They never got within, like, 1 foot of me, but they did come my direction. That, I don't know what for, but I was a little intimidated by that, because at that very moment, I did feel threatened. I didn't know if they were going to take me to jail or, like, drag me out of the courtroom, because that's the vibe that I got from them. And the judge then told me, he said, you know, if you are not you, then why did you come to court? You know? And I really didn't know how to answer that.
No, question. I mean, you should have answered, well, I am me, but I'm not him. I'm not this corporation that you're trying to actually create a Georgia to. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm me.
Right.
I mean, that's the right answer. Like, who are you? I'm me. But who are you? I'm me. I am.
Yeah.
You know, I am that I am.
Yes. Like I said, I'm learning. So I was just skeptical about what to say and what not to say. So I basically started not talking to them, just kind of keeping quiet. And I still didn't acknowledge that I was me. And
no, that you was the straw man, that you was
right,
a corporation.
That
because it's not you.
Okay.
Yeah, that's just a corporation.
Right, that. So it got to the point where the judge was getting frustrated, and he felt like I was taking up too much of his time, and he just wanted to get on with the case. So he told me that I can sit down and think about what I wanted to do. And I
told, what did you do?
Well, I told him I didn't want to sit down because...
Cool.
No, but then I sat down.
Really?
Yeah.
That's not good. No, because you took orders from a judge.
Mm-hmm.
So when you take orders, then you're giving him authority over
mm-hmm.
you. And authority is jurisdiction.
Right.
Like, no one really tells, like, a sovereign or, you know, a man or a woman what to do. Like, for instance, if he tells you, well, sit down, and they use that. They've been using that trick because
mm-hmm.
I talked to someone else. And she was like, the judge said, well, you know, you're going to sit down until you figure out what your name is.
Yeah.
So she went to sit down. And then she called me. And I was like, why'd you go and sit down? Like,
mm-hmm.
instead of just leaving, she should have been like, you know what? I think I'm going to go out here and sit down for a while, and I'll be back. You can't take orders. If he gives you an order, you know, you turn it around like, well, you know what? I'm going to go and sit down here for a while, and I'll be back in a few minutes. You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
But you don't want to take an order, because then you're subjugating yourself to the court's authority.
Yeah.
And it gets real tricky, I mean, especially if, like, you're in there and...
Yeah.
Yeah, it's kind of intimidating, right?
I didn't know what to say. But, yeah, at the end of the day, the only thing that happened was I still got a new court date, and I didn't sign any papers. That's it. So I'm just going to have to fight it when I get there and see what happens.
So, yeah. So, like, what... Me, personally, the way I would actually handle that, because I can't tell you what to do. I don't give legal advice. Me, you could have actually possibly granted them jurisdiction already. Mm-hmm. But, so, I would find out what type of charge, like, do you have a paper that they gave you, like, stating the charge? Is it criminal? Is it civil? If it's a criminal offense, then, according to the Bill of Rights, Article 6, you're entitled to a trial by jury. So that means if you're going into a quasi-traffic court, there's no jury. So you're in the wrong court. If they tell you that it's a civil offense, according to the Bill of Rights Article 7, if it's more than $20, you're still entitled to a trial by jury. So even if it's civil, then you're in the wrong court. So based upon that, traffic courts, family courts, are really all essentially illegal courts because there's no juries. So, in order to, like, get it into the appropriate court, you got to move it. You got to move the trial to your court and say, you know what, I'm moving this because I'm entitled to a trial by jury. But the first thing you got to do is hold them to the oath, or office. So, when you go into the court, you know, you always want to have something on the record first. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not really good to talk in court because lawyers, they try and get you to talk to create arguments.
Right.
It's okay to argue. Argue is Latin. It means to make clear. But when you get into arguments, like polemics, that's how lawyers defeat you because you think they're speaking a certain language that they're not. Like you're saying one thing because we're thinking in common parlance, but they're talking legalese, so they're speaking a total different language. And we're getting like, well, no, well, you said this, but no, you're getting like totally discombobulated here. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I would try to move the case to the correct court, which would be a court of record. And if you define a court of record in Black Law 4, it tells you that it's absent of the person of the magistrate, meaning that there's no judge presiding over the case, but there's a jury, and supposedly the jury is supposed to be of your peers. So the only thing that the black robe is supposed to be there for is to make certain that each side is being heard, not to make decisions and say, well, I'm going to charge you with this, or I'm going to charge you with contempt. Mm-hmm. But that's what happens when you go into their courts, and that's how you know they're in their courts, because they don't enter a plea for you.
Right.
Like, previously you said that he entered a guilty plea or something like that, but they found you guilty. Yeah. So, yeah. But that's about it. That's all I wanted to bring out. You have anything else? Any questions? Any questions for me?
Well, I think you've all answered that. I just wanted to know, like, what steps could I have taken differently with the whole birth certificate, you know?
No, I mean, it's not so much that, like, when you go into any kind of court, you always want to have something on the record prior to going there. Mm-hmm. Like, at least 48, maybe 72 hours prior to your court date. So, say if you're scheduled, like you're scheduled to go back in March, right?
Yeah.
So you look at the docket sheet, find out which date that is, and then we're doing everything in the heading of an affidavit because that's a sworn statement. Mm-hmm. And any unrebutted affidavit stands as a truth. So if no one brings anything against that, then what you stated is true because you've done it under oath. That's the part from getting the notary and all that.
Right.
You took an oath. So, you put your affidavit on the record, and then when they ask you things in court, you refer them to the record. It's on the record. Did you not get my record? It's all there on the record. So, and if they ask you questions, you answer it in the form of a question. Because he that is asking is asked the king. Mm-hmm. And the king is the authority. Like, the person that's asking the questions is usually in charge.
Right.
So you want to be the one that's really asking questions. If they ask you questions, you answer in the form of a question. Because when you start to make statements, now you got to prove the statement that you made. Mm-hmm. And we can't prove anything. So you always respond to them in the form of a question. Or it's such and such here today. I could be referred to as that. Or I'm here to hear that case. Or I'm here as intervener to challenge all charges outstanding. How may I help you? Are you tied to DACA or not? Well, I can be referred to as that. My son refers to me as father, so I mean, I can be referred to as that also. So it becomes a game, and that sometimes frustrates them, and sometimes they'll delay it, sometimes they dismiss it, but you just gotta stay in the right mindset.
Stay focused.
That's it? All right, so we're gonna bring this to a close. That's probably about 15 minutes or so, but thank her for like giving her testimony.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you like the video, give it a thumbs up, share it with your friends, family, peers over YouTube. And remember, if you do not assert your rights, then you don't have any. And to assert one's rights is to do so with confidence and certainty. So, Tazadat, saying shalom. Shalom, yashallah. How about shalom?
At that time, young Pharaoh's packet, he got pulled over in Georgia on parole and nothing happened. People knew it was real.
Debt collectors got you dodging all their phone calls. Documents notarized, about to send them all. Discharged with an EFT or APV. Send in a copy of the UCC. Call at a tender payment. They acquiesce whenever they don't say. Debt collectors got you dodging all their phone calls. Documents notarized, about to send them all. Discharged with an EFT or A for V. Send in a copy of the UCC. Call at a tender payment. They acquiesce whenever they don't say. Avoid joining with the corporate fishing greed, man. Conditionally accept your offer upon proof of claim. Sending letters all caps, I am not the name. HJI192, I'm up on game. Moving different, everything discharged. Three-step process, learn from Kahan. Before 30 days, mail affidavit. They could respond negative or don't say shh. Debt collectors got you dodging all their phone calls. Documents, notarized, about to send them all. Discharged with an EFT or A for V. Send in a copy of the UCC. Call at a tender payment. They acquiesce whenever they don't say shh. Debt collectors got you dodging all their phone calls. Documents, notarized, about to send them all. Discharged with an EFT or A for V. Send in a copy of the UCC. Call at a tender payment. They acquiesce whenever they don't say.
Sleep on beds and nails, walk on water, spit fire. Feed 300 millions, walk on lava. Holding the Holy Bible, bell. Beatings felt as vicious as a lion's whelp. With my felt tip pen, I write words in sight. Revolution, war against financial institutions. Women compel into seduction. Who's in power? The mighty dollar. Giving up the biological property. These loans on the homes. The debt of me. Gas prices got the people sobbing. The system is robbing. Mad as hell. I rage up in Harlem. It's an atrocity. The rich is debt free. I lean up the ass with a UCC. Financial Merrill Lynch got a noose on me. Lacing up my boots and kick this truth. Time to repent and save yourself. Kahan Tazadat redemption process.
Debt collectors got you dodging all their phone calls. Documents notarized, about to send them all. Discharged with an EFT or A for V. Send in a copy of the UCC. Call at a tender payment. They acquiesce whenever they don't say. Debt collectors got you dodging all their phone calls. Documents notarized, about to send them all.
Last but not least, if you are looking to get a status correction done, family, and you're not looking for somebody to play you, or you're looking for the results to get done, I'm personally stamping this. So I'm personally recommending this, family. This is not me just talking why, and I'm going to show you why I'm personally recommending this. I recommend you go to a brother named Tazadat. He's on YouTube. I cannot think right now off the top of my head of his exact YouTube name. But hit me up and I'll share the link. If y'all need it, I'll share it on my Facebook. But outside of that, the brother gave me permission to give his email out in this video for anybody looking to get their status correction done. He charges $750. Now, for most of y'all saying, oh, why would somebody pay to do your status correction? Well, if you're somebody who doesn't know how to do this paperwork and you're looking to get your shit done correctly, because believe me, I tried to do it myself and sent some paperwork in and they sent that shit right back. So if you want your shit done right, or you don't want, or you want it done correctly, because we don't know everything and there are some things we need help with, then it's well worth it to become free from the system. So now with that being said, This brother does respond. He does email. You can call him on the phone. He does talk back. He's not a one of those type of brothers. Now, with that being said, his email is creditorsdebtorscontracts@yahoo.com. Spelled creditorsdebtorscontracts@yahoo.com. creditorsdebtorscontracts@yahoo.com. The brother's name is Tazadak, Tazadak. Now, why would I personally recommend you to this brother saying that he does paperwork? Because he did mine right here in your face. You can see it. Now, I'm not going to zoom in because it's personal names and things on there. I kind of spread it out, but you can see this is just one pile. These are instructions on how to fill this out or how to fill my names in the blanks and how to send it in. And this is more paperwork here, family. As you can see, it got the sticky notes instructing me on where to put my name as well as other instructions. And like I said, I'm not going to zoom in too much because it's personal info. But now I can tell you from personal experience, this brother will do your paperwork. I actually just sent my UCC financial statement off this Monday. I'm waiting for a response. The brother did, it took him 3 days to do my paperwork. Family, so when you write him, he might say, oh, it takes 2 weeks for him to respond. But that depends on how backed up he is. But I can vouch for the brother. He does respond. You can call him. And like I said, he did mine in 3 days. Not saying expect to get yours done in 3 days. It might take the full 2 weeks. But I can say the brother will get on your paperwork same day, same night. It's easy to pay him. It's not hard. You can either pay him over to his email. You can pay him through PayPal or you can Walmart to Walmart him. You can work that out with him personally. But just want to let you know that if you are looking to get your status corrected and you are looking for your work to actually get done right and somebody do you right, then he's going to do it right. He's going to do everything right and exact, and he's not going to play. So I ask y'all, if y'all do go to him professional, y'all. Please go to him professional because he's going to come to you professional. Now, clearing up these, what was said on Sineta, first, about Nature Boy. Why Nature Boy said that, I don't know. I didn't tell him to say that, y'all. So, for one, please, y'all, don't keep writing me in my inbox asking me do I do status corrections so that we can go to Africa. Hell no, I don't. The man said that shit on some other shit. I don't know why he said that. It was live. As y'all know, when I'm teaching the people, I try to stay professional as possible and don't blow up in the middle of shit like I be wanting to. But I didn't tell him to say that. I do not do status corrections. That is who does status corrections, Tazadak. Now, for everybody else telling me, okay, Pharaoh, we hit polite or we pay or we did whatever on his website to do our status correction and he's not hitting us back, can you holler at him? Da da da. Personally, I want y'all to know, as y'all may know, I may be in contact with a few people from around that circle, but I have nothing to do with the actions of other people. All I can do is speak from my personal experience. I know, personally, me originally went that same route, and I don't want anybody to take what I'm saying and say, don't take what I'm saying, personalize it, and use what I'm finna say to go further your personal beef or your personal agenda that you may have with anything. And contrary to what I'm finna say, I'm only speaking from personal experience, not egotistical hatred or agenda, but just so people who's writing me this can understand that this is where I'm coming from and why I went the route I went and why I'm giving you this route. In October, I did go through that route, through the New Covenant route, to pay for my status correction. Skipping a long, drawn-out story, my status is not corrected through New Covenant, and it did not get corrected through New Covenant. So now, for whatever reason, why people, maybe because we all understand what's going through the air. Maybe whether people saying polite is a scam artist, whether they saying he doesn't have enough staff. I'm not here to chew on that or put that out there. All I will speak upon is what is factually happened, which is I did go that route initially, family, and I did suggest that y'all go that route as well. But that is the end result I ended up getting, which is my status did not get corrected. So if you were somebody who followed me and you went that route, then understand that we got the same exact result. So I did not intentionally mean to walk you into this outcome because I share the same outcome as you. So for everybody in my inbox, asking me the same question, we got the same result. So now with that being said, without dwelling on that, yes, I'm not here to throw flamethrowers. I'm not here to blow up grenades. I'm just here to let y'all know that I did also get the same result as you. But if you are still in the avenue or still in the want to get your status corrected, get them two books, self-educate yourself that I provided. Hit the email up of the man, brother Tyler.
Blessings. I just wanted to make a short video in regards to becoming a secured party creditor. First of all, I want to let everyone know that it does work 110% as long as you fill out your paperwork correctly and as long as you know what you're filling out, okay? You can't just fill out paperwork and expect, you know, magic. You need to know what you're filling out. You need to understand what you're filling out. You need to understand and you need to overstand it because they will challenge you in every way possible, okay? They will tell you that you're crazy and what you're talking about is not correct. But when you know what you know that you know, and you can defend it and back it up with truth, right knowledge, and with true law, then there's really nothing they can do but honor what the law says that they have to do. So anyways, another thing I wanted to mention is if you are interested in becoming a secured party creditor, I suggest you contact this brother by the name of Taza Doc, okay? You can look him up on Facebook, Taza Doc Shaw Bay. It's T-A-Z-A-D-A-Q, Taza Doc. You can look him up on Facebook. You can also look him up on YouTube under The Deprogrammed Enlightener. The Deprogrammed Enlightener. This brother has so much information on the web, and I think he's been like on YouTube putting out videos since like 07 or something like that. He has so much information on child support, traffic tickets, court summons, common law, civil law, like all of that, okay? Stuff that's mind-blowing and that's going to help you in the long run. So again, if you're interested in becoming a security party creditor, I suggest that you contact him on Facebook or on YouTube, or he also has an email. It is creditorsdebtorsandcontracts@yahoo.com. That's creditorsdebtorsandcontracts@yahoo.com. I think that's what it is. Like I said, the brother's legit, 100%. He'll construct your paperwork for you. All you have to do is fill in the blanks. And send it to the correct people, put them on notice, you know, follow the instructions. He gives you instructions. He'll talk you through it over the phone or whatever you need to do. He'll work with you. He's very flexible. He'll work with you. Okay. He's a very honorable man. I can say, I'm not going to tell y'all something I haven't done myself. I actually met with him in person back in November of 2015, and we spent like 3 or 4 hours together going over this paperwork, him giving me an explanation, which he doesn't even usually meet with people, but I was like, you know, I need to meet with you. I want to sit down and talk about this so that I make sure I understand it, and he was willing to, you know, provide that service for me. So like I said, he will work with you. His prices are reasonable. He's honorable. He knows what he's talking about. He knows what he's doing. Take notes. Go to his page and listen to all the videos at least 4 times so that you have it embedded in your brain so that you know that you know, it's just like knowing your birthday type stuff. You know what I'm saying? Like that's all I used to do is sit and watch his videos at work the whole 8 hours. I got my headphones plugged in, my tablet set up, my notepad, and I'm taking notes. And like a lot of the stuff I know because I watched it so much. And then like there's still stuff that I have to go back and watch again just so I can, yeah, I need to touch up on that. But I suggest watching his videos before you contact him. Watch his videos because all the questions, I promise you, every question that you have, he has answered it in his videos, okay? So if you just go to his page and research it, you know, catch up on everything, embed it, then go to him, ready to become a secure party creditor, already knowing what you're getting into, knowing what it is, knowing the history, knowing the root, the background, you know? So, I don't want this to be too long. I'm not one to be in front of the camera. I just wanted to let y'all know this because this is real. It can help a lot of people get out of debt. That's what it's really for. Because, you know, there's really no money. There's only IOUs. Real money is silver and gold. We don't have that anymore. And when they did away with that, that's when they created the Social Security, your account. That's what it is, your Social Security account. That's when they gave you the Social Security card. There's money there for you to discharge your debts or to set off your debts. But I won't get into all that. That's his job. Go watch the videos. Contact the brother. Again, Facebook at TazaDocShabe. YouTube at The Deprogrammed Enlightener. And his email is creditors, debtors, and contracts@yahoo.com. Again, blessings and peace, family. I love you all so, so very much. We got to get this together, okay? Peace, love.
As you see, you hear the testimonies for yourself, but there's more. Enter Sean Watt.
Mr. Schwer.
Was good, it was good. I need to charge my phone up, man. Yeah, man, we over here winning, man. My boy up in Boston, he his joint jumped another 200 points. His joint jumped just off of the doing that second for value popping in the coffee status. So I wanted to hit him up. He's probably at work, but let me see if I can win.
Yeah, I mean, usually that doesn't fix your credit. Because, it, you know, when they look at the credit report, it generally says discharge. So I'm not sure what he actually may have done. Someone that actually knows how to read a credit report, they know that there's a difference between discharge and actually, you know, allegedly paying it off.
Yeah, he his shit was in the 400s.
Oh, right.
And I just helped him with his, the secure party creditor package like a month ago, and or 2 months ago, and he accepted for value and wrote a letter because I used the same template for my letters when I did my acceptance for value, and he didn't even certify mail it. He just mailed it regular mail,
right.
And he this was like a last chance thing, like you know, he didn't have no more money, but he just like he did everything that he could do, and he just mailed. He did the letter, the cover page, and he did the acceptance for value on the stuff that was on his credit report. He pulled his credit report on Credit Karma, and he showed me how to go on your accounts. You go under overview in your accounts under Credit Karma, and it's free. And you pull up every person that says that they owe you on your Equifax, Experian, the TransUnion.
Right.
And you have all the addresses right there. So he pulled all the addresses, the corporate, all the addresses that, for the people that said that they owed him. And then he found the CFO and corporate office of each business that said that they owed him. And he wrote letters to each one. And I'm telling you.
Well,
he called me last week and he said my joint jumped 100 points.
Well, that's what improved his credit report. It wasn't really the acceptance of value. The fact of the matter is that according to law, for educational purposes only,
right.
When you contact someone that actually has something in your credit report that's not authorized to be there, and you tell them to remove it, and if they don't remove it, now you could actually penalize them and charge them a fee or sue them. So that's probably why they, you know, they removed it. And then that, by removing that, the score goes up. So
right.
If there's anything else on the report that's unauthorized, he may want to contact the alleged lender and get it dismissed, especially if it's, you know, some debt collection agency, which actually has right. nothing to do with her. Oh yeah.
Let me see if I can get, let me see if I can ring him one second. One second.
All right. Red pill, right knowledge. Folks, it's a de facto feminist oligarchy. A target dog, Sean, for deprogramming right now. On YouTube, the Undaunted National. On YouTube, a spokesman from there.
Yo, yo, we right here, fam.
Shalom.
Shalom.
I can't hear the other brother.
Hello. What's up, y'all? What's up? How y'all doing?
Shalom, shalom. This is Brother Curtis. Hey, are you on a headset? Because the last time I think someone was on a headset, and that means the call like extremely distorted. If you're like on a headset or a Bluetooth, it'll really distort the call.
Hold on, give me 2 seconds. Let me fix that.
Good. Yeah, sure. But I talked to the brother Lone yesterday.
Where?
Yeah. I don't know why he's still playing around. I guess, you know, he said he's getting education from that court. You know, but I keep going in on that, you know, alleged DUI charge. I told him yesterday, listen, man, the next time you go in, what you need to do, it's, you know, for the record. And if it's not a court of record, he needs to take in his own court reporter so he could actually make it a court of record. Because then everything he say is pressing the record. Otherwise, everything that's being stated, it's, you know, up to whether or not the judge is actually going to entertain it. Yeah. And trust me, he's not going to write down anything in Lone's favor. So what he needs to do, man, the next time he go in, is say, is there anyone here with a verified claim against me? Not something that's verifiable, but a claim that's actually already been verified. And if there's no claim that's been verified, then he needs to actually move the court, because he's actually the moving party, to move the court to dismiss the case for failure to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. Because if there's no verified claim, then there's no claim to be stated upon which relief can be granted, so they don't have a stance. Like, you know, I explained that to him yesterday, so hopefully the next time, you know, he go in, he'll get it thrown out and just totally be done with it.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You ain't telling what's happening, Kurt?
Yeah, man, it's unbelievable. So, like, you know, I pulled my credit report, and I, you know, there's a lot of things I just basically, when I went back to hometown, I stamped everything, accepted it for value, and I'm back out of town doing my work thing, and I keep getting these cards and these letters and these offers in the mail, like, pre-approved, this, that, and the third, and I'm like, what's going on? Let me check my credit score. Man, I kid you not, 200 points jump.
Oh, all right, so it's 200 points. Yeah, all right.
First it was 100. Then, like, a day or so later, I took the pictures, it's another 100. So I'm like, man, like, everything is, like, falling into place without an issue. You know, it speaks for itself. When you handle things properly and go do the paperwork the right way, there is no problem. Because they're going to get research, and it's like, okay, that's fine. But I have everything to back it up. And, you know, any questions, feel free to get in contact with my agent.
Right.
And I told him about your cover letter you had, you showed me, if you shared with me as well, that was very professional, and it helped me with my acceptance value. And I was just so excited. I was feeling tired about it. I was so excited because it was just like, man, we're coming together and we're learning and we're educating ourselves. We're here, and that's what it's all about. It's about getting remedy and getting free from these debts by educating ourselves. I was just reading HJR 192 this morning.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I had
excited to be in that position because you lead by example. Because honestly, my whole family, like, you know, you try to explain to people the gist of it and how it works. It's a complex thing, but it just sounds too good to be true for them. So I'm like, no, you got to realize this is, you know, America's a corporation for a profit, and you need to educate yourself and understand what this means. And there is a remedy when you go about it the proper way. And I'm happy that, you know, everyone around me is like, wow, this is real. Now they're seeking to educate themselves and follow the steps to freedom, because that's what it is, honestly.
Yeah, I mean, that's good, you know, in a sense, but in another sense, man, I feel like smacking the shit out of some of these people. Because, I mean, I'm wrong, man. Yeah, I'm just keeping it a buck, man. I'm going to take it back to the streets for a minute. Now, because, you know, before, you know, people do the testing, what about this? And what about this? And what about that? You know, I had someone yesterday, man, that I had done, you know, a packet for, you know, this sister, and I'm not going to say her name, but I mean, she was just, like, concentrating on little tedious things. Like, oh, time to doubt. It says right here in my security agreement that, and she knows who she is, that I'm a Christian, and I'm not a Christian. I said, hold on, sister. So you're wasting my time emailing me, telling me, and I guess she's like, maybe she's a so-called Moor or Egyptologist or something like that. I said, so you're emailing me, telling me that you want me to go back and change your security agreement and strike out Christian to redo this? You gotta be kidding me. I said, what you really need to do is concentrate on the stuff that I be talking about. If you run contract law, you would know the only thing that you need to do is to strike a line through that and initial it, since you don't want to be affiliated with Christian. And if you really understood what a true Christian were, you wouldn't have a problem with it. Because these people, their whole system of law is built off of scriptures, man. It's built off of scriptures. And so I told her, furthermore, if you don't know the scriptures, you're not going to be, you know, you're not going to have really a legitimate standing in this, because you're not going to understand where this kind of stuff is coming from. So people like that, man, if anyone is listening to this when I upload it, if you're going to come at me sideways like that, then don't come to me for any kind of help, man. For real, man. Because stuff like that incenses me, man. That incenses me, man. You're wasting my time with something like that.
What they don't understand is the security agreement is between the secure party and
right.
the debtor.
Right.
So if you are the secure party and you have your security agreement, retype it and put whatever you are. If you're a Mormon,
you are.
If you're a Muslim,
right.
if you are atheist, whatever, type that in. But the whole point is, Tata Dot is doing the package for people to free them, not to do every single thing for you. If I lead you to water, I can drink and show you how to drink, and you can do that. But when I'm not around, you have to drink for yourself. So the thing is this: you got to read the security agreement, and you have to understand the security agreement, and then type up your own security agreement. You have a template right there. It's the only problem you have is the name Christian. Then retype it.
Right.
That's the thing. They don't have that frame of mind to be a go-getter or to be, in other words, a creditor. They're still stuck into that debtor frame of mind because that's how they were trained. And
right.
It's like until they, I don't even know how to really attack it, because it's like, I felt a lot of people are getting set at learning. Sometimes they do need to see it, you know? And so, I mean, I did my own research. I went through this thing without a doubt. So I'm like, watch, you will see. And some people are just going to be stuck in that frame of mind and won't be able to be released. It's just how it is. Unfortunately,
I helped her become a secure party creditor, and he's helping me do acceptance for value. Do you understand? Like because it's all about whoever wants to take time out and read the information. Like I'm focused on helping people become secure party creditors. This man, I helped him do that, and then he took off doing stuff that I haven't even done yet. So it's not even about when you get in or when you hear about it. Just whenever you get the information, research it immediately for yourself, and then act upon the information that you get.
Kurt.
Apply it.
But you know what it is, man? Kurt has that hunger that I had when I first came in. When I first came in, you know, I had just left my job. I'm out here broke, fucked up. Ain't nobody
right.
giving me nothing. Ain't nobody trying to help me in nothing. You know what I mean?
You're taking all your time.
So that's when you had that hunger, man, like a fighter. So, I mean, you be a different kind of animal, man. You see things from a whole different level. It's kind of like a fighter, you know. Before someone get the championship, man, they fight hard. They train, you know, hours upon hours. But when they get that championship, some people get real comfortable, and this is where we make mistakes. Because if you're hungry, you know what I mean? You're never really hungry. You never really hunger on a full stomach. Because if you eye, and I don't really want to hear that, but if you got that hunger, you got that eye of the tiger, then you're a different kind of animal, man. You know what I mean?
Right.
You're a different kind of animal. Yeah. So, I mean, that coach coming at him like that, man.
Yeah. Yeah, he sure is. Hold on. Because they playing games with us, so I got no time for the game. Well, I wish they would. My God.
So, yeah, it's all about educating yourself, continuing to learn. Once you become a good right there, continue to study so we can apply all the laws and see ourselves in that way. Because you have property, you know what I'm saying? You have debt that you can tackle. You have putting yourself from 9 to 5 and doing something with your own talent that can create money. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of different things to do as a secure party creditor. So it's not even just doing paperwork and becoming a secure party creditor on paper. It's about what are you going to do once you become a secure party creditor? How are you going to use your God-given talent to even free yourself from your 9 to 5 so that you can utilize all... Tom Scott just wrote another book, man. Come on. He was just out here in California, D.C., Atlanta, St. Louis, you know what I'm saying, doing all these conferences. I'm helping the people that I'm bringing to him, and it's like he's still writing books.
Yeah, in the background. I'm in the background still doing work.
I'm like, this long sent me the book. Like, yo, he got your book. I'm like, wait a minute, he wrote another book? Like, when? So it's like, it's up to you with what you want to do as a secure party creditor, even when you become a secure party creditor. But some people,
that's not it, folks. That's great, but that's still not it. Intersum Sack had 2 DIs, 2 different states, and he also defeated the IRS, secure party creditor, all the way under Kahan Tazadon.
Hey, Shalom, what's going on?
Shalom.
Yeah, you want to call the brother Lone up if he's not busy?
Yeah.
You saw that video put up that you're talking?
Oh, yeah, man, I love it.
Yeah, yeah,
man.
You had a lot of good energy in that video.
Yeah, it's a testimony, man. Our lives are testimonies, and the Most High is using us to show others that you can be an undaunted national as well, and you do not have to be in dishonor and argue as a debtor, a doubter. I like to call debtors doubters as well. And
right.
you can stay quiet and be in honor and still win. But yeah, let me call them right now.
All right.
Oh, yeah, by the way, that ticket. You saw that 2-4 ticket? Who's talking to you?
Did you see the email that I forwarded to you? Shalom.
Shalom. Hello, you there?
Yeah, man.
All right, cool.
Hey, so, Lone, what we actually want to do this time is kind of do a recording. So, you know, if you could actually give a little bit of descriptive information in your California Mandarin accent as a testimony.
Also,
yeah, go ahead, brother.
Also in Utah. He also represents stuff in Utah as well.
Right.
Yeah, in Utah.
So,
federal court.
Right. So, I mean, typically, let me get this correct. You was actually being charged with 2, what was it, DUIs or DWIs?
It was a DUI over here in California when they
say that the CHP over here, the Highway Patrol over here, he got irritated when I stated that we were having a party at my house. I was partying at my house, and he stated or he came into my property, and he was just snooping around, and
so they were trespassing.
They were trespassing, so everybody was thought we were just being too much. So I went out there and go talk to him. I'm like, how can I help you, sir? What's the emergency? Is there an emergency? And then he's like, I was just coming here to see if anybody's if anybody's hurt or anything. There seemed to be an accident down the road or something. And then he said, sir, do you have a warrant? And he said, no, you know, you're trespassing right now. And he says, the gate was open. And he started interrogating me with some incriminating questions. And I told him I was heavily intoxicated. As soon as I told him I plead the fifth, he just said, you're under arrest.
So he illegally, he trespassed and came on your property and stated that the gate was open and that's why he was allowed to trespass on your property. And then he arrests you on your property.
Without a warrant.
Without a warrant.
So no, let me get this correct. Now, did you invite him onto your property?
No, sir.
So anytime, you know, just for the record, you know, for educational purposes only, and by the way, this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. Sean does not offer legal advice. Lone does not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, you could come to the counsel and please be advised. So now, anytime that anyone is actually on your property and you have not invited them, you could actually, you know, demand them to leave your property. Especially if it's your property, it doesn't matter whether or not the gate was open or not, were you invited? If you're not invited, then I'm giving you an order to depart. And if you do not depart within the confines of my home, because, you know, there's a maxim of law that actually states that the man is king of his castle. So knowing thus, now I'm not suggesting that, but the maxim of law that states a man if king is his castle means that I could use force to remove someone from my castle if I've actually determined whether that person is actually a threat or has actually became a threat. And, you know, again, you know, there's other statutes that states when a police officer acts where he doesn't have the capacity, then you are to treat him, you know, like a regular violator of the law.
Right. And that's what they are.
Right.
And that's what they did in that situation with Loon.
Right.
So situation, I was put in the junk tank for a couple hours.
In the what?
I was incarcerated for a couple hours.
So
in the junk tank to put me in.
So he took you from your. He took you from your castle, you know, by force, you know, you didn't consent to it, and incarcerated you.
Yes.
Now, let me,
they incarcerated me. They also assaulted me. They forced a blood test upon me. I have pictures and bruises, so I'm building a case against them.
Now, did you go into a debtor status, like arguing with them or, you know, claiming not, you know, to be, had broken any law, acquiesced? Did you start behaving like a debtor?
No, I stated they're really irritated because I acted the way I was supposed to act, even though I was heavily intoxicated. They asked me, is this your name? I stated, I go by a name similar to that. He stated, is this your birthday? I stated, that's what I was told. Heavily intoxicated. And I was stated, it was hilarious. These guys were like, oh, he's one of these free inhabitants. So they already, like, already biased against me from the very get-go.
Well, so yeah, they like to put titles on us, like, oh, he's a free man, he's a sovereign. And as soon as they do that, I always correct them to let them know that, hey, I have no clue what you're talking about. I'm just an aggrieved man. I'm just an aggrieved man. The only thing I know is I'm just an aggrieved man, a living soul. Anything that they say that I don't agree with, I correct them on it. But so from there, so how was you actually able to conduct yourself in a manner that, you know, the average debtor would have actually went into dishonor? Had you actually been studying some contract law, anything, you know, what was your methods that you actually used to stay in honor?
Well, the methods I've used was directly straight out from, was from multiple sources, but my main sources was from your books.
Okay, and so I guess you offered conditional acceptance, I suppose.
Yes, I did. I offered a conditional. Actually, before I even I had a case prior to this, and prior to this court case, or prior to that happening. So I've had interactions with the court already. I've been perfecting my art of just
right.
How to present myself in court.
Correct.
And they have some good feelings. All right, Dave. One minute. They know my name around, but certain police officers around here, they still have no clue who I am. But
right.
So I walked into the courthouse to turn in my affidavit of reservation of all of my rights. UCC 1-308. And then the DA saw me walk in, and he didn't even want to deal with me. There was my name wasn't even on the calendar anymore.
So initially, okay. let me get this correct now. Let me get clarity. Sean, are you still there?
I'm still here.
Yeah. So if I understand this correctly, so they was bringing two different charges against the good brother for DUI, a DWI. Was there any other kind of infraction that they try and hit you with?
Traveling on suspended.
Okay, traveling on suspended license. Now, was there any kind of paperwork that you actually may have actually been filing under the process of doing all of this? Any kind of secure party creditor paperwork or anything like that? Had you been working on correcting your status, anything like that?
I've actually started correcting my status as of... I started studying the SPC process about, say, April.
Okay.
And I started commencing my paperwork.
We did your paperwork just 1 month, a couple weeks ago.
Just October. So yeah. I just recently had it, actually.
But he's had it. I mean, I done that for you, what, maybe 6 months ago, 4 to 6 months ago?
Yes, you did.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure I learn contract law and everything before I utilize everything. So,
right.
Tell them what happened when this actually went to court. How you were in honor, judge.
So when did you last go to court? Let me back a little bit. So now they're bringing you multiple charges against you. So now. You know, you've actually been, you know, standing in honor, acting like an honorable man, you know, if you will, free man on the land, a national, an American national, so on and so forth. But in the process, now you've recently filed your secured party creditor paperwork. And since you've actually filed said paperwork, you've actually been invited into court again. And so you voluntarily went into court. And then what happened then?
I went to the court. Before I even walked into the courtroom, I went to the court through court and turned in all the necessary paperwork I needed to. And then.
So you had something on the record. You didn't just go in the. You didn't just go into the record. I mean, you didn't just go into the court like a buffoon and just try to argue viva voce. you actually had something on the record. Okay.
Hey, Lone, tell them what you put on the record. Tell them you gave them your U61 paperwork.
Yes, I actually got my I sent them my acknowledgement that I got back from from New York.
So you filed a UCC-1. So you put a lien against your debtor.
Yes, I did.
Oh, okay. Oh, okay. Yeah. Oh, all right. So you put a lien against your debtor. All right.
Right.
And then after I put a lien against the debtor,
So that means, I guess if you put a lien against the debtor, you probably also filed a whole harmless agreement, which means you, the living soul, would actually be held harmless from any kind of charges that they actually bring against the debtor.
Right, right. Yes.
Oh, okay. I'm just trying to understand this. Okay.
So after all that was done with the initial filing with New York, I came over here and put this court, my local court over here, on notice with all that paperwork also. And I had everything file stamped with my local court. And all the charge, or that case that I did get the, that supposedly they're trying to charge me when they kidnapped me from my house, it disappeared.
It mysteriously disappeared. So since you put this on the record, it's mysteriously disappeared. They've come up with some reason. Well, we don't have a case for you. And I could tell you, Bubba, just from my experience, it's not that they don't have a case for you. It's that they've known, hey, this man has actually changed his status, and we can't just go against him anymore as we would a typical ward of the state. Because now you're, you know, operating from a different capacity.
Yeah, different status.
Oh, I was... When he said, there is no matter today to be heard, there is no case. Huh. I just had the biggest
Beautiful.
Smile on my face.
Beautiful. Beautiful. I mean, so how did that make you feel? Did you say, oh, well, man, so Tyler Doc is not a liar?
Hey, yo,
I always knew Tyler Doc was real.
Yeah. So, I mean...
This stuff is serious and heavy, man. He said, the public defender told him he was his hero.
Yeah. Tell him what now, brother?
I had a public defender. So Friday, so I actually had last Monday, okay? And right. that was with a judge that I had, like a regular judge that usually sit in this courtroom. But Friday, I had a substituted judge for that first case, and they threw me a judge from out of town.
All right.
And so I had to prove my status and everything else once again. So when I went in this time, he called the name, and he said, "Are you this name? Are you the debtor name?" I stated, "No, I'm the principal interest holder, and I'm here in
Tokyo." So hold on. I'm a bit confused here. So you're not loan? You're not loan?
That's the street name, son.
Oh, I thought you was loan. I've always called you loan. I thought. So you're not the name?
No, I'm not the name. No.
Who are you?
Nobody's a name. I'm a man.
Oh, okay. And so you don't live in California?
No,
man,
I don't live
dang, all this
California.
Time I thought you was living in California, man. Okay. Hey, I'm learning.
It was hilarious. This judge didn't know what hit him. So this judge didn't know what happened. I mean, the clerk of court knows me. The DA knows me. Everybody knows me besides this judge from back town. He said, oh, I'm going to appoint you a public defender. And I already have all my paper on record. I just took a little break, went to the hallway with the public defender. And the public defender, right when we got out of the hallway, he goes, bro, you know you're my hero?
Wow. So you got attorneys calling you a hero. Because you are actually the attorney in fact for loan. You're the attorney in fact for loan. And once people understand that they're not the name, they will begin to have more success, man. and we'll begin to have more success, man. And it makes you feel a little different. The first time that this stuff worked for me, man, I just had, man, I wanted to teach everyone that I could. But everyone I would try and teach, oh man, that stuff ain't real. And then every time I would try and show them something, oh, well, that worked. Well, what about this? And you're always going to have the naysayers. So I learned that it is not my duty to convince anyone. And like, when you know, when Yeshua was going out and he sent, you know, his apostles out, he said, you know, you go out and you teach the people. And if someone do not hear you, if a house do not hear you, then shake the dust on them. And it would be worse for them on the day of judgment than it was for the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. So our only duty is to try, you know, to articulate this to people. But if they don't want to receive it, then you shake the dust. Because once you've done that, you've done your job. Just like, you know, Ezekiel. When you go and read the book of Ezekiel, you know, he said, I set you up as a watchman to warn the people. So when the enemy comes, you need to warn the people. And then you wash your hands of their blood. And if they die in their sins, your blood is clear of their hands. But if the enemy's coming and if you're not warning the people and the people are dying in sin and you didn't give them a warning, then I'm going to charge you with their blood. Basically the same thing, man. Basically the same thing. It's allegory, man.
Wow.
So allegory.
See?
Yeah, man. That's what it is, man. So, you know, I'm glad, you know, you was actually able to experience this yourself, because nothing is like doing it yourself. Because you're actually learning yourself.
Tell Tazza Dot that, the judge told you, you know, stop showing off. Because the way that you...
That happened in the federal district court.
In a federal district court.
Yeah, the
Article 3 court. That's an Article 3 court.
He kept telling them that he will not create joinder, and so they kept moving him to another court because they couldn't do nothing with him. So they had to up it up to the federal court.
So what happened is I walked into the federal district court. I was all, of course, I was all in my tux and suit and tie. I had my briefcase with me. And
did you have any pinstripes on? You have any stripes on your tie? You know, just for the record, in case you don't know, because I pretty much know their whole game. If you ever go into court and you have a pinstripe suit on, and if you have a tie on, you got to make sure the tie, the lines on the tie, is going from the left to the right. And that is symbolic to when a man would actually draw his sword, he would reach over from the left side and draw his sword with his right hand. So they look for little things like that. Little things that we would never think about, they look for stuff like that because it's built on the system of masonry.
So you're saying 45 degree angle down?
45 degree angle, that's it. 45 degree angle down. Same way that I do my acceptor for values.
Wow.
I had a feeling there's something symbolic about that.
Yeah. Symbolism.
Okay, and then after I walked in, after he called the debtor name, I stated, I'm here in pro per persona, here to hear that case.
So you didn't stand up and identify yourself as the name that your parents gave you?
No, sir. I said, I'm here to hear that case.
So you're hearing it straightforward, ladies and gentlemen. I have not coerced loan into saying anything. It's just, you know, a brother that, you know, I've been working with for some period of time, but I'm not, am I coercing you to say any of this, Brother Wong?
No, sir.
He's just, you know, this is another testimony. And, you know, what's startling is that people hear testimonies again and again and again and again, but many still cannot lose that debtor's mindset. So some people are just not going to get it, brother. But go ahead.
I stated, he said, oh, sir, would you please just step up to the podium? And I said, I'm entering the bar, reserving all my rights, waiving none. And said, sir, please just enter the bar. You know that talk you're talking is not going to work.
Who said that?
The judge.
The black robe said that to you. That the stuff you're talking is not going to work.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I'm entering the bar. He's just trying to scare me.
Yeah, that's a test. That's a test. That's a fear tactic, and it's a test. But guess what, brother? Most people track up under that test. Because, right. You know, someone, you know, sitting, oh, that's not going to work. Immediately, the typical person would have just broke down. Like, damn, what do I do now? And go into panic mode. But you stand fast like a creditor. That right there, what he gave you, was a channel offer. That stuff is not going to work. Now he's waiting to see how you're going to respond. This is what they do. Look for some way to get us to go into dishonor.
So then what happened?
And after that, I walked up to the podium. Then after I walked up to the podium, I told him I'm reserving all my rights, and he asked me, he said, all I want to do, one minute, I got another call. I'm doing a report right now. I got a girl up there.
Yeah.
So where was I at?
So tell him the part after you walked in, and then.
So that was a lot that you actually didn't share with me. You and Sean must have had an actually long conversation because Sean knows all of this.
Yeah, we talked a lot. Yeah. So after I got it. Okay. So after I walked up to the podium, he said, "All I want to do today is read you your charges and read your rights and read you your charges." Instead of a preliminary hearing. And then he talks to the attorney, the county attorney, district attorney, and then he says, do you have the documents? Can you hand him the documents? And then they bring up the documents to the podium, put it on in front of me. He says, sir, do you see your name on that piece of paper? And I said, no, I don't. I see, is that his name? I didn't say that yet. But. So, and then the black robe goes, Mr. Bailiff, can you please go and show Mr. Nirvan where his name is on that piece of paper? I should have said objection, but I didn't. And then, so the bailiff walked up and pointed to the debtor's name, all capital letters. He says, is this your name? And I told him, no, sir, that's all capital name. That's fiction. And
wow.
Then the judge cuts me off. Goes, sir, you need to stop that talking. It's not going to work.
And this is in a federal district court.
Like this. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes, okay.
He asked you about your birthday.
Yeah, he moved on to that. But before that, before the birth date, we got to the address.
See, there's very same things that I told people they were trying to get you with in my videos. They were trying to get you to a zip code, an address, a social security number, a birth date.
Mm-hmm.
Go ahead, brother.
Then he stated, okay, that's he just moved. He moved past the name. He's just trying to change the subject. He goes, okay, since that's not the name, it's the address down there. Is that your address? And he said, I don't have an address, sir. I have a mailing address. I'm in care of an address, and then
and it's somewhere near ready.
Yeah, and then I stated that I started to state the actual number. I said, in care of, and then I stated the number, and I stated the street, and I stated the Reading, and then I stated California, gave it him a pause, and then I said, Republic, near, and then I gave him the zip.
Wow. So on record, he did not create Joinder with himself, which is the whole game of the court, which is the whole point of them even having him because that's why they want him to create joints with him so that they can create commerce.
Cards.
And then after we moved on, after they got that recorded on the record, because they had a different address on there. After I corrected my address, is in Kara. Then he moved that. He moved on to the birth date.
Oh, this is fun.
Okay. Now you see there's a date underneath that. Is that your birth date? And then I told him, my mom told me I had a date similar to that.
What was that? What was that, brother? Repeat that.
I told the black girl that my mother told me I was born on that date.
Right, because it's hearsay. Because when we're born, we're actually too young to know exactly when we're born. So it's all hearsay because someone else told us that. So you was right.
And then he starts to say, oh, come on, I know you weren't a baby when you were born. Like, really? I was a baby when I was born. I don't know, what do you think I was? And then he goes, and then after he got a little bit irate, he goes, after he stated that, come on, I know you weren't a baby when you were born. And he goes, you need to stop showing off. So that's when that phrase came out. I was trying not to laugh so hard.
But once they test you and see that you know your stuff, then they give you the pass. They give you the pass. Because, you know, again, man, when I was actually in court this last time, man, it was totally, like, hilarious. The way that he treated my son's mother versus the way that they treated me because I went in as a creditor. I mean, she literally cried in court like a damn baby. And the black robe said, hey, man, you know, I've seen it all. The tears are not going to work with me. You know, she didn't have anything on the record. She went in with nothing on the record. Went in, you know, just trying to speak. Viva voce. Everything that I've actually had to say is actually already on the record. I simply referred them to the record. Smashed. That trial literally took like 5 minutes, man. It was over. She was done. Toasted.
The cold-blooded part about it to me was when she tried to say something to Tyler that, and the black girl was like, yo, anything that you had to say, I would say to him.
Right.
She's a debtor and he's a creditor.
Because she didn't have any standing and she didn't understand that. I understood what he was saying. He said, well, ma'am, is there anything you would like to say to me that you want to say to him? And she sort of stuttering and all. And he said, well, ma'am, is there, I mean, he let her babble off, and then I didn't even say anything to what, you know, she said to him. Like, well, yeah, that's fine. You know, I object. That was it. I object. That's not true. And so after that, he said, ma'am, is there anything else? Nope. I guess that's it. So, well, okay. Well, I'm good. My decision is that the children remain with the father. And so we're going to reschedule this court date for December the 13th to determine whether or not you need supervised visitations, if you receive visitations at all. Because I entered something else into the record when I went. She didn't enter anything else. She didn't enter nothing in the record. She just went into court and tried to talk. Smashed it. By Hashem Hamash Yahweh. Totally smashed it. Left out crying. And she put on a damn Hollywood performance, man. Trying. And this woman be talking so nasty over the damn phone, man. Nasty.
I remember you said something. You said she deserved an Oscar or something, right?
Right. Right. Yeah. That's the way I felt. Are you serious? She's really in here crying like that?
Really, no.
I kind of feel like that was about the black robe. They deserve a couple Oscars themselves.
But a lot of them know their stuff, man. A lot of them know their stuff, but they be just testing us to see if we know what we're claiming that we know.
Oh, yeah. So the birthday wasn't even the end of it, right? So after he was done with the birthday, he's like, okay. And then he goes, okay, sir. Okay, what's your name? He said it just like that, out of nowhere. Just trying to come at me. Like, so what's your name? I need your name, sir. He's trying to intimidate me. And I was like, oh. And then I told him, my name is, I go by many names. I told him.
Wow.
I go by many names.
That's one of my lines that I usually hit him with.
I remember that. And then he goes, sir, I need your name. What do you go by? And I told him, I go by Somsack. Okay, is that your first name? And I say, that's the name I go by, Somsack. And then he goes, is Nirvan your last name? And then I say, no, that's my family's name. And then he goes to read me my rights. After all that charade, then he reads me my rights. And sets a preliminary. And then he goes, okay, so we're going to set a preliminary date, see if the state of Utah has enough evidence to proceed. So I'm about to send him another UCC reservation rights and another fee schedule. And that case was happened before I corrected my status.
Right.
So that was a fun experience in federal district court.
You stayed in honor.
Yes, sir.
It's beautiful, brother. Beautiful. Beautiful. The creditor gets a victory.
Yeah. We can't lose.
It's always beautiful. But, you know, I wouldn't suggest to get, like, some of the people that I know that's actually filed the secure party creditor stuff, and then they get, like, really big-headed and cocky and go out and just, you know, just trying to throw their weight around, man, and, you know, just go and act a real radical. I don't suggest that kind of behavior, man. I always suggest stand in harmony, man. Yeah. Yeah, there's no need to, man.
Yeah, there's no need to. Because there are people, too. Some of the cops, I mean, I was thinking about filing lawsuits on some of these cops. But some of them, they don't know no better. They're just trying to do their job.
And like you said, we don't have to be in dishonor. We don't have to be rude and come with the wrong spirit, because once they see the contract, once they run the game, it's already the contract is already lost.
Right.
It's already there. You don't even have to say mumbling words.
Con.
Just trying to pick and choose on who to actually. Actually go after some of these corrupt cops. I mean, I have no problem going after these guys.
If you're enjoying these testimonies of these people that actually became Secure Party creditors on the Kahan Taza Dog, be sure to give a thumbs up.
Hey, slow on.
Hey, it's better than getting a call from the president when I hear from you.
No. I never want to be in that capacity, man.
Yeah, I know, but let me tell you, it's nice to hear from you. Well, that Rosanna Rosado, her office sent back saying that they reject any claims or demands. I wasn't making any claims or demands. I simply notified you, and you've been noticed. So
right.
She's been served, and she's been noticed. It didn't come back from her. It came back from her office. And the letter says, this is just to let you know that there may be information of interest to you that was filed. I'm just notifying her. So there's no demand stated in there or any claims.
That's nothing. That's absolutely nothing.
Yeah, that stands as truth and everything. That's she's been served. They're just playing their games like they're playing stupid.
Yeah, I mean, that was simply just a notification, a record notifying you that, hey, my status has changed.
And it doesn't matter because it's actually in the public record with the UCC anyway. It could be looked up in the database. So it's there. The question that I have was, yeah, they're funny. They try to slip you up, make you nervous. I said, let me just double check, because everything I'm learning, I'm like, you got, if you're standing in front of me and I say, hey, watch, there's a car coming, and you get hit by the car, and you say, I reject it, you told me that, it doesn't change the fact that you heard it.
Right.
So very illogical. But with the acknowledged filing number that they gave me, that's not in the packets that I sent. The only one that's in the packets is the one that I got online, which should be good, because with the UCC, that online filing number is attached to the new number they gave me.
Right, and that's what I was actually
trying to. But I didn't go out with my packets, because I didn't send the packets out with I didn't send the packets out after I heard from the UCC. I sent the packets out after I got the online number with that number.
All right. So I mean,
that shouldn't be a problem, right?
I mean, no, because one number could just simply reference the other number, because you said that you know, they referenced that number. But yeah, that's kind of like a first time that they do something like that at someone. But I guess it's because so many people are starting to file, you know, these documents. You got a lot of people doing this now, you know, and so they're becoming aware, because, you know, I was, you know, coaching one brother, and he was saying that you know, he went into court, and when, you know, the black robe asked him, you know, for a name. And, you know, he was like, I'm here to say, he said, oh, you're here to, oh, you're one of them. I'm not even going to deal with this today. Just get out of my court. So, you know.
I'm sorry, brother. The call dropped.
Yeah, I'm not even sure what happened. I was still talking. I looked. But I said, you're still there. I didn't hear anything.
I keep going.
Yeah.
They talked through the brother of the court, you were telling me.
Yeah. I mean, because, you know, when they try to get him to prescribe to the name, you know, he said, I'm here as intervener. And he said, Black Robe was like, well, oh, I see, you're one of them. I'm not even going to deal with that. Get out of my court.
So, I mean, did he state that, you know, are you implying that the trust referring to case number for, and did he give that at all? He just said he's here to intervene.
Well no, it just, he said, I'm here as intervener. He said, are you such and such? And the guy goes, hey, I'm here as intervener. And he said, the black world say, oh, I see what's going on here. You're one of them. Just get out of my court, and don't you ever come back in my court. And so, you know, I told him, when things like,
you can't do that.
Right. When things like that are stated, though, I wouldn't take orders from the black robe. I'll say something along the line, well, in the past, I've said, like, well, if there is no one here with a verified claim against me, then I'm going to be leaving. Because if every moment I take orders from the black robe, then I'm under his authority. And a lot of people don't get that. So, you know, this is why you got to be like...
That's the game they play. The game they play is from learning from what you said. The game they play is any way, word, shape, or form, or situation to make you adhere to them, to make you subject to them. And if they're asking the questions and you're answering them, they are king and you're not sovereign.
That's right.
When they ask a question, you need to ask the question and you need to take charge of that. If you're not taking charge and directing this, no, I am as king require that you... tell me what. Tell me. What is the jurisdiction of this? Is this a criminal court? Like you said, where is the injured party? Where is the damaged property?
Right.
Does anybody here in this courtroom have a verified claim against me? So then you are the prosecutor. You are the administrator. You are the executor. Am I wrong for this trust? And get him frustrated till he starts to shit his pants. Is that correct? But politely.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct, man.
Okay.
Right. A lot of people do not, they don't want to learn it. They just, they want to go in there. They don't want to learn. You know what I mean? You're a thinking person. So it works out pretty good with you, because you're questioning everything. But the average person that I deal with is not like that. They won't question.
That's our nation. Our nation is so high strung, and they got such a grudge that they want to go in there head on. What they don't realize is you're not going up against a man here. You're going up against a court of sorcery. This is Jedi mental warfare. This is trickery of words. This is nothing that you're familiar with.
Right.
And they don't get it.
Yeah.
I've been doing this for 5 years following you. Until now, until I finally said I'm ready to do this. You know,
right.
I took 5 years, bro. And I'm still only 10% of the way there. I would not even consider myself a death. But let me tell you something. I fall asleep to your YouTube videos because I want it embedded in my subconscious. I listen to you with As a Man Thinketh. I've listened to that over 25 times.
Yeah, that's very deep.
In the armory, of his thoughts, he forges the very weapons in which he destroys himself. I mean, come on. Listen, I'm there with you. And once I perfect my discharging and I go before the court, because I'm going to get rid of this mortgage and everything, I'm going to have them give me what's the payoff amount, and I'm going to discharge that. And if right. not, I'm going to call them out on between 4 to 8 different counts of fraud on the note, and right. politely call them all out and threaten their positions and bring out the fraud. They're not going to want that fraud brought out. They're either going to call recess to change jurisdiction and try to switch me up. They're going to dismiss it, but I don't want to dismiss. I want right. to discharge, set off, and this account closed. I want my house free and clear.
Right.
This
right.
is inherent rights that the Creator gave me. I have dominion over everything in this land. Everything, especially man-made. And if you know, that's what the thing is. When they say, "In God we trust," in the courtroom, they're not telling you what God they trust in. You know? Mm-hmm. That's very sticky. Listen, I just have to say thank you. You know, this has been a long journey for me, you know, and it, like, it's a lifestyle. It ain't a journey because it ain't ever going to end.
Yeah, but and, so, I mean, ultimately, you did get your secure party creditor documents filed. And, you know, I believe it's because, you know, you took the time and strategically, you know, went through everything in the proper order. And really question things that you may not have actually had clarity on. But the average person Absolutely. Don't want to do that. They just, I want to file these papers. And then when they run into some sort of commercial presentment, what do I do now? And then they want to call me. And I was like, brother, this is why I explained to you, you have to understand contract law. You have to understand how this works. And you have to believe in yourself. I was talking to a guy.
Gave me the tools. You actually, and you gave me your books, which actually give examples of how you may want to go about this. You know? Examples and everything. So a person can look and see that, make sure all the legal wording is there, customize it to yourself with your own information, you know, and legality. But you need the Black's Law Dictionary, because if you're changing either one word like "in" or "on," that throw the whole shit off. You gotta be careful. They don't think a little. They think big words count, but they skip the little words. And it's that little word: upon, in, on, at, is. They don't get it. I don't get it either, but I'm 90% closer than they are. You know, it's a process. It's a lot of work. Let me know when you need me to let everybody know that, you know, you're a man of your word.
I mean, you could actually do that now, because, you know, I mean, and a lot of people starting to vouch for that, brother, because, you know, there was this brother, you know, I'm not going to give his name, but, you know, he's facing he's facing a federal indictment, you know, so, you know, and the brother is kind of in a dire situation. And I usually don't meet people in person, because you never know what kind of funny people out there that want to live in a cartoon world.
I know, that's why I was so upset when I missed you May 2nd. Yeah. I was like, damn.
Yeah, but you know, I just came back from Alabama, man, because I went down there in person to actually help that brother organize his paperwork, and he was really, really grateful, man. And you know, in the process, I learned a lot more about holistic, you know, foods and herbs and all of that. You know, I thought I knew enough.
Yeah, you're in good shape. You look good, brother. You look really good.
Yeah, so I appreciate that, brother. But this brother had a wealth of knowledge on that, like the proper herbs. You know, like, you know, totally alkaline body. So he had a sister
alkaline,
down there.
Alkaline, yep. Alkaline versus acidity, man. We have acidic bodies.
Right. But I mean, his sister has pretty much cured herself of cancer. Like, a few years ago, she had
cancer.
That's
the real key, man.
Yeah, man. But I mean, so I was like, wow, this is some good information. Because, you know, I know some people with lupus and all of that.
We learned, like years ago when I listened to that Manly Hall, he said, it's about learning to live by living to learn.
Right.
You know, when you take that approach too, you know what I mean? You learn to live because you're living actually to learn. One, you know, like if you would learn to listen, you may eventually listen and learn, you know?
Right.
They go hand in hand.
That's right. Yeah. But yeah, man, it's just, you know, just because there's some people that, you know, I've actually interacted with, and then because they didn't listen to what I suggested to them, when things didn't work out for them, they wanted to blame me. It's only like a couple of them, you know, and then they'll go out and put derogatory, you know, videos and all of that. So this is why I've been, you know, asking.
That's not in my nature. I'm low key, bro. I'm low key. And you know what? If anything came back or does come back, then, you know, anybody sends me paperwork back or anything, first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to scrutinize and go over my process. The second thing I'm going to do is ask for any recommendations to rectify. I'm not pointing no fingers. You know, when you're driving, if somebody gives you the car and you're driving the car and you have an accident, you can't say, oh, you didn't tell me where the blinkers were. You didn't tell me where my hazards were. Listen, you're driving the vehicle, brother. You either know how to drive or you don't. You either confident enough and assess your mental state before you get behind that wheel. Don't put the blame on no other man. That's effeminate men, bro. They want to point the finger, whine and blame. Nah, that ain't how my household is raised. I raised two boys, bro. I bring up men.
Yeah, praise be the Most High.
We don't do that.
Yeah,
we don't do that. Nah, we don't do that, man. Come from a martial arts background. My father was a brown belt, Eastern Conference champion, fourth degree black belt. I studied Russian Sistema with Spetsnaz soldiers that actually killed terrorists.
Right.
We don't play games, man. You know, like one body said, we ain't Christians. We put you on your back, man. We're not here. You know, you don't like my fringes. You got a problem looking at me. What's that? If you don't know what this is, it's not for you, brother. Keep it moving.
Right.
I'm not thinking, you know, we hard in the Bronx, you know. I live in a very peaceful and beautiful area. That's what I was saying. When you're around, you want to come through for a barbecue, bring your friends, whatever. You're more than welcome to come by my place. We got the Rottweilers. We well protected over there, man. You know, we do good. We do good. And like I said, yeah, it's funny. It's nice to laugh at you because I go online, I watch these camps and stuff, and I start laughing, man, with all the divisions. Then when you did the indigenous people and universal people, I said, you know, that's more like it, because even though some people aren't in this truth and they're still going to go to other doctrines and stuff, they are still our nation. It's up to us to set the example. You know, instead of fighting amongst our own nation because of religious, which don't exist, differences, and sorcery, because they're tied up in magic, we're going to stay with the benevolence of the Most High. You know, Yahweh Basham, Yahweh Shah. You know, we're not gonna stray from that. But at the same time, you know, we gotta try to pull these Gentiles our way. You know, we gotta bring them back to Yahshua Allah. You know, we gotta bring them back the right way, and we can't do that by aggressive means and by indifference. You know, it don't work. That's why what you're doing. I commend it, man.
Yeah, of course.
Because I'm Puerto Rican, most people think I'm white. I get a pass. It's like, then you find out you're Puerto Rican. Let me tell you, shit changes. Shit changes. They see you around so-called blacks and Negroes, and they see how you get down. You can hang. Shit, I walk in the projects. I ain't got no problems. You know what I'm saying? I'm riding the elevators in Bronx River, Mott Haven. You know what I'm saying? I go see a friend. Hey, I got people in the projects, you know? When I'm walking in, brothers that don't know me either say, yo, that's a cop. You got to be easy. Or, you know, let's try to rob this nigga. And that shit hasn't happened yet. So.
Yeah. Yeah, but brother, but, I mean, you know, just for, you know, anybody out there, was there ever a time that, you know, between, you know, your interactions with me, that I seemed like I was deceptive or trying to get over on you or some con man or anything like that?
Spare not. What is that? Isaiah 56:1 or 58:1? Spare not. You spare not.
But
you lift your voice.
Sean Watts had 7 felonies when he came to me, and he ends up on a do not detain list. Secure party creditor all the way. What are you waiting for?
Because I want, you know, it seems like you actually turned into like Mr. Untouchable. You know how Malcolm X, they call them Detroit Red? We're going to have to call you California Red, man. You know what I mean? it seems like you became Mr. Untouchable, man, like John Gotti or somebody, Nicky Barnes and all them cats, man. Only thing, they wasn't secure parties, man.
Right. They wasn't secure party creditors, man. Look, just yesterday, man, I'm driving, and I'm trying to be on the low. I'm driving at nighttime, and, you know, I'm trying to be on the low over here in Laguna. Now I'm out here in Laguna this time getting pulled over. Two sheriffs pulled up in a truck behind me, you know what I'm saying, on the main street in Laguna. And I'm like, man, like, oh, here we go again. And I didn't have my camera. You know, I'm going to buy a camera today because I'm going to start filming it. So the guy comes up to the police officer. Constable on patrol comes up to me, knocks on the window.
I rolled the window down. Hey, you know, I pulled you over because you don't have any tags. Your tags are expired. And I said, and I don't have any insurance. So he said, oh, okay, you don't have any insurance. No, that's okay. So, you know, let me get your license. So I said, here's my license, and I don't have any insurance, and I'm just trying to get home. I live right up the street. I was just trying to get some food. Last night, about 11 o'clock, almost 12, midnight. I'm just trying to get some food and go back home. So another police officer comes at behind this building, and Darkness. And she said, I was over here posted on the corner, and I just wanted to help you out. So he slides my license over the top of the car to the other lady and to the other constable on patrol, and she runs back and runs my license. So I'm already knowing what's about to happen. So he's sitting up there like, yeah, man, you don't get, you know, why are you driving a car with no tags and you know, no insurance and all that stuff? I'm like, well, you know, my wife's a nurse and she drives my car that has the insurance and has the tag. And, you know, I while she's at work, you know, I might need to get some food or something around the house. I mean, around the corner from the house. So I'm going to run down the street in my car that don't have no tag. But, you know, I'm not trying to be on the freeway or nothing. I'm just trying to slide to get some food and slide back home. So he was like, well, do you do any drugs, do you have any illegal drugs inside the car? And I'm like, man, no, I don't have no illegal drugs inside the car. Yo, while we're in the middle of our conversation, I heard the lady say, yo, he's a sovereign. He's a secure party. She was trying to whisper it to him while he was talking.
Yeah.
So I'm already waiting for something for this to happen. So she slides him on my license over the car. Like, yo, he's a secure party. He's a sovereign. So he didn't think I heard him. So he's like, oh, yeah. So he grabs my license, then he comes back to the window trying to act up. He's like, yeah, you know, I can impound your car right now for being 6 months over registration. Now, mind you, my car is only 3 months registration because ever since I've been on your videos and become a secure party creditor, I haven't paid for my registration in 3 months. We haven't even been 6 months. So I don't even know what he was talking about. He was just trying to act up like, yeah, I can impound your car because it's been 6 months past registration. It's like, man, if you could do that, if you could even give me a ticket, you would give me a ticket. Don't try to front like you could tow my car. You got to let me go. And I didn't say this, though. I was just being humble and, you know what I'm saying, being silent and acting like a secure party creditor. And I just said, oh, sir, you can tow my car, huh? And he said, yeah, I can tow your car if I wanted to. And I said, oh, wow, thank you for not towing my car. And he's like, yeah, and just go home and make sure you don't drive this car without any registration. Make sure you go get registrations, and you have a nice day.
Mm-hmm. yeah. Okay. So he gave you a depiction of how they really exist in the cartoon world. They even try to delude you, you know. And this is how they get, you know, power and authority over, you know, people in the court, is because a black role plays semantics with them, and they think he has some sort of authority that he really doesn't have.
Over him, power right. Over him.
Right.
He wanted to exert power over me. Even when the lady ran my stuff and he knew, she said, he's a sovereign. He's a secure party. Even after she said that, he still was like, you know what? I'm gonna treat this dude like I'm not even going to let him know I have to let him go. I'm going to just treat him like I can still do him dirty. And I can see the difference now as a secure party creditor than when I was just a citizen, you know,
right.
With my will submitted to any constable on patrol or any black role. It's like we are willingly giving our power to them over us.
Yeah. So you know what you may want to consider doing, good Bubba, if you you know, if you're gonna be, you know, I wouldn't even refer to it as a car. I refer to it as a conveyance. But if you're gonna be actually moving around like that. The documents that you actually submitted to the UCC division, you may want to submit them on a local level to, like, you know, the local county level and the local, you know, so that the local sheriff departments and all that could actually be put on notice, and they will know not to keep trying to pull you over. Because that's the hassle of why I don't have, you know how some people have like the diplomat plates, or, you know, they just got free men written on their plates. The reason I don't do that is because I got tired of getting pulled over so much. And then it resort to them just having to let me go. At least 15 or 20 times, man, they would pull me over, I guess, until, you know, they figure out who I were. But they wanted me to break into that, man. But with me, they would bring in dogs, want to search my conveyance. Well, I don't consent to a search. Well, we got to search it anyways. The dog bumped the car. Okay, well, I'm not going to try and stop you. You know, you got a weapon on your side. But, you know, I just, whatever they wanted to do, I conditionally accept their offers when I was on the side of the highway or whatever, but it was when I was set at liberty is when I constructed my documents up and started making these people, you know, recognize, you know, I am that I am, you know. I'm an agreed man. I'm the most, I'm a reflection of the Most High in the flesh, you know what I mean? In the flesh, man. Then they started kind of leaving me alone. I really don't get the, because, man, I used to get pulled over everywhere. Everywhere I would go, these, you know, these constables on patrol pulling me over. Just kept pulling me over, trying to get me to break. And this is why you got to actually also have the mindset of a secure party creditor and not file paperwork. Because some people are break under that, and they start arguing and go back right back into that debtor mentality, and then they get you. That's how they get you.
You know why you're so right about that? I didn't tell you this either. On Thursday, I get a call from the Superior Court of Orange County, and it's an automated call, and then a lady jumps on, and she says, hey, is this Sean Watts? And I said, hey, I'm the secure party creditor. I'm the secure party of Sean Watts. So then she says, oh, well, I can talk to you then. And so I was blown, because that's the first time I had a conversation with the police department and let them know verbally, hey, no, I'm not Sean. I'm a secure party. And she understood what I said. And she said, oh, okay, so I can talk to you about his bills. And she said, well, he owes $1,500 in tickets. And instead of arguing, because what you said is you need to be in a secure party mindset, I said, hey, I conditionally accept that $1,500, even though I only have $400 a ticket, and I paid the ticket cleaner to go to court for me, and they went to court for me, and they still, after I paid $400 for them to represent me in court, the court still charged me $400. Then when I didn't pay, then within the month, they added on like $400 a month. So now
it's crazy.
$1,500.
It's crazy.
So I said, instead of arguing with her and said, no, I only owe this, I said, hey, send me that $1,500 to my P.O. box. My debtor's address. Basically letting them know, you know, I'm not that man,
right. But
I'm the secure party, and you know what? I'm not going to argue with you about the price. Go ahead and send that. Because as soon as you send that, I already got my stamps ready to do my bill of exchange, and I'm going to give them more than what they asked for. I'm going to give them $1,500.
Right. Yeah. And you never want to admit to no owing anything. Well, you know, send the alleged debt, you know, whatever you're alleging it to be, because that way you're never meant to own anything. Well, you know, I'm his authorized representative. I'm the authorized representative of Thousand Dollars. How may I help you?
Right.
You know, right. Would you like me to give him a message?
Right.
So I deal with that, man. I mean, seriously, man, even when someone calls me and I don't recognize the voice, is this Thousand Dollars? Who wants to know? Well, so-and-so. You said you owe me $150? Yeah, well, I'm not Tyler Doc. No, we have a warrant for his arrest. No, I'm not that Tyler Doc. But I could get him a message. Who are you?
Right.
You know? This is how we got to deal with him, man. This is how we got to deal with him.
You got to know you're the living, breathing person. You got to know you're not the corporation.
Yeah, it could be someone coming up to you some constable on patrol coming up with a warrant. Are you Tyler Doc? Because why are they asking me that? Because they obviously saw, you know, a photo of who most people think is them, and all I actually have to do is identify with the photo, and that creates joinder. Then they're going to arrest me instead of the debtor. So who wants to know? Oh, well, yeah, I conditionally accept your offer upon proof of claim if you have a bona fide charging instrument that you could present to said instrument now so this matter could be set off, settled, and closed now. Bang!
Wow.
Even if they don't present that instrument, hey, man, I'm still going to conditionally accept everything, and I'm never going to consent to being the name. Because I know if I don't consent to being the name, they can't get paid off of me, and they're going to eventually let me go anyways. Problem is, most people break under that, man. Yeah.
Scared of the cops. Scared of the black robe.
Yeah. Yeah, man. But it seems like, you know, you're handling yourself very well.
As Sean Watts began to study more, really began to dig into the books and do his research, he started to get excellent results. To the point where he went and bought his own land and raised his French bulldogs. Secure party credit.
Yo, what's good, fam?
Hey, it's cool, brother. How you been, man?
Man, look, man, I've been good, man. Look, man, you a spam, brother. I cannot believe
No, you, man. I'm just visiting, man. I'm just visiting, man.
I cannot believe how real this information that you are giving us all. And I cannot believe how much information and everything that you have said is so real, son. Do you understand? Last night, I got pulled over by the sheriff, and I didn't realize that this is the second time I got pulled over. The first time, it went over my head on why I got let off. But then the second time, I realized it. Man, I got pulled over last night. I was swerving, and I was leaving the country, and I didn't think that there was any police officers out there. It was pitch black. It was at nighttime, and I was driving, and I was swerving, looking for my earphones so I could listen to some music on the way back home, because it was an hour and 45 minute drive, and I'm swerving on the median and swerving, you know, off of the road, but you know, there's no cars around me. Not that I think it. And out of the blackness, out of the darkness, there's a police car right next to me, and he actually pulls up to the side of me like, "Yo, are you seriously driving like this?" And then I see him, and I throw my seatbelt on. So then he sees I'm black, and he jumps behind me, and he pulls me over. So he shines a light. You know what I'm saying? He's like, "Yo, like, are you drunk?" And I'm like, no, I was looking for my earphones. And he said, "I saw you just now put the seatbelt on. Like, why didn't you get the seatbelt on? Why are you driving crazy?" And I'm like, "I didn't expect anybody to be out here in the middle of the country. I live in Laguna, 2 hours west here, and I'm leaving my people's house over here in the country just getting my dog pregnant. And I have my dog right there."
Cool.
And so... And he said, "Well, you should really take care of that before you even get on the road." And he said, "You know, I'm gonna give you a sobriety test right now." So son, he gives me a sobriety test immediately. So after he gives me a sobriety test, he's like, he said, "Do you smoke?" I'm like, "Yeah, I smoke marijuana." He said, do you have a license for that? A prescription for that?" I'm like, "Nah." And he's like, "Well, you know, that's legal in California." He was like, "But do you do any other drugs?" I said, "Marijuana's not a drug, it's a herb." And so he said, "Let me get your license for a registration." And he said, so I gave him my license and my registration and my insurance. And so, because really, I had herb prescription on me, in my armrest, and so, but you know, I'm not drunk because I don't drink like that. So you know, I'm good. So I passed the sobriety test. So he takes my information back to the car. Son, this is where everything turns. Son, he came back to the car in less than 60 seconds. In less than 60 to 120 seconds, 1 to 2 minutes. He's back and running my stuff. Boom. Comes back, gives me my stuff, and says, "Yo, keep your seatbelt on and have a nice day." And son ran back to his whip. And I pulled off. Like, what? So his whole demeanor and whole countenance and everything changed once he ran my name.
Right.
And that's the second time that happened. So I said, This boy, Tyler, died.
But it's not really me, though, brother. It's just, you know, it's the process itself. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I mean,
you the way people
are. Same story that you're telling me. Brother Pharaoh told me that same story, man, 2 years ago. Well, you know, he's on probation, you know, he ain't supposed to be out of the state. He got pulled over in Atlanta. Boom. Don't even come up in the system at all. Nothing comes up. He's thinking they're gonna get him on a probation violation. Let him go. They told him, do you have any ID in the system? Because he said he didn't show up at all. So, I mean, immediately he called me after that. I was like, yo, man, I've seen cases of that, like, happening, but, I guess, you know, people come up somewhat differently, you know. But that's nice to know, man. But did they ever send you back your acknowledgement from, you know?
I just sent that back to them a week ago because see what happened.
All right.
2 weeks ago, I sent them everything properly as we talked
about. All right.
But then I didn't write in the name of the NYS Department of State. I had to put that in the name part.
So
I did that. I just mailed that in, so this should be sent in fact. But I'm just off of the initial filing of 2 months ago. Like, everything that you're saying, son, on those videos, all the information, everything that you're stressing, all the paperwork, like, son, I'm so happy that I paid you, and I'm so ready right now. You know me and Malone just got off the phone. Me and Malone talk every day. You know we're getting ready to have another 2 meetings to have you come back out here in the next 2 months to Southern and Northern California because, dog, now I got physical proof. Now Malone has physical proof, son, not just filing. I'm talking about, like, real dealings with the law. Malone stuff got, all Malone's court cases were determined before he became a secure prior creditor. Once he became a secure prior creditor and I helped him with his paperwork a month ago, now the shit's not even in the system, friend. Come on. When you said, what are you waiting? That's how you got me. You said, like my man said, what are you waiting for to become an SPC son? You don't even know how real that is. That is the number one paperwork that you need to sign. Contract is law. And with that contract, 2CC1 paperwork, that is the number one information. That's the number one thing that you need to be doing if you are a citizen.
As you hear testimony after testimony, Kahan tells a doc's method walk. Become a secure party creditor now. What are
you? Shalom. It's Taza Doc Shaw. And before I go into this video with my brother, with my op, Sean, I want to be able to just drop some right knowledge through the spirit of Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shah, that will actually, I hope and I pray, permeate through your walls of doubt. I pray that you could actually, you know, undergo a summation of your thinking and then not squander in the valley of indecisiveness anymore. All of my videos are didactic. They are intended to teach you something, but some of you are so unbridled that it becomes a natural paradigm, a natural tandem for you to behave like a daft. See, my words are not intended to besmirch someone's character or feelings. In fact, I come off as very urbane. But some of you get discombobulated over the most scanty situation. Oh, Taza Daka got my secure party creditor, unpack it. The punctuation's wrong. The spelling's wrong. Get your mind right, queen. And I hate to say it, it's usually the women that's complaining. It incenses me to think that something so insignificant like a period will encumber you from getting your documents on the record. Better hurry up before it's too late. If it is not your name that's misspelled, if it is not your address, why are you focusing on such minute discrepancies? I've given you a hodgepodge of right knowledge, and what you should actually be focusing on instead of trying to engage in polemics, because many of you, you're a polemics extraordinaire. Instead of trying to focus on polemics, what you should try and do is comprehend and understand the legalese that's in those documents. You're always reticent when it comes to you, but you're always looking for an external discrepancy. So I challenge you in 2018 to stop making excuses. And if you want to become a secured party creditor, you will need to get your minds right now. You will need to gingerly get off of your lazy excuse-making behind and do it now. Do the work now. Do the studying now. You must implement a plan from this moment forth, because tomorrow's not real. Stop putting off things for tomorrow. If you keep putting off things for tomorrow, essentially, you're just going to end up with a lot of empty yesterdays. You need to renounce the Satan of self. Your heart needs to palpitate to right knowledge. Stop making excuses. Do the work now. Let's go into this video. Hey, and by the way, the website, Creditors, Debtors, Contracts, and Commerce, I disabled that website. So if you want to find me, you can find me at www.truedisciplesofchrist.org. If you want services, coaching, so on and so forth, that's where you get it. www.truedisciplesofchrist.org. Tazza Doc and Sean is about to go into this video. You need to listen to this video no less than 5 times so it can actually be embedded in your subconscious mind, because many of you, you're still not getting it. You're still doubting. So your works without faith is dead. Get your minds right. Get your minds right. Get your minds right now. Right now, not later, not tomorrow, not 5 minutes from now. Get your mind right, king. Get your mind right, queen. You're going to have to decide. Debtor or creditor? Which are you?
Mr.
Doggett, I'm highly disappointed that you believe or must have believed that I was lying to you or something, because you seem a bit startled, man.
I'm elated
by your spirit, but I'm disappointed that you seem a bit startled. Oh, yeah, Taz Dot probably making this up. Now you're a believer. Now you're a believer. Just like the other ones. Now you're a believer. Now you're a believer.
Yo, man, this is...
Now you're saying secure party creditor is real. I'm telling you, man, I discharged the car, I discharged my student loan, I discharged the house, man. Now you believe it, now you see it for yourself.
Are we stupid? Is this superhero stuff? What is wrong with you? So, niggas can't get locked up, can't get no tickets.
I mean, they can if they screw it up. They can if they don't understand contract law.
If you're an asshole and you just want to be a retarded sociopath that just go out and hurt people, yeah, I'm talking about for me, though. I'm talking about me. I've been trying to be on the low for so long. I've been trying to, like, but I wasn't even doing it right. The SPC, that is the way to do it, man. Like, that is the way. That is the way. To operate in this sea of commerce, man. Everybody is trying so many different ways, hustling, you know what I'm saying, doing this Ponzi scheme, you know what I'm saying, doing this, doing that, and it's like, yo, they not getting nowhere, man. This is the way, bro. This is the way, bro. Like, I'm tripping right now. Like, I just sent that letter less than a month ago. I didn't accept it. First of all, ever since I've been dealing with you since June, I've been living off the credit card like for 6 months. I'm up to $16,000, and I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna take this dude for for real. And I really, I just went on faith and I prayed to the Most High and said, yo, I'm rolling with this cat. So that happened in June. And so I haven't hustled. I haven't sold no threes or no nothing. I've just been living on my credit card. Man, I finally ended them around Christmas time. And I'm on the phone with Daryl. I had to get off the phone with my uncle when you called, because I was on the phone with him. Like, I'm like, yo, you know, my credit score went up on the 3rd, and I'm waiting for it to go up again, you know what I'm saying? And Daryl's like, you know, it's going to be a process. And while I'm talking to him, I'm checking my Credit Karma, right? So today, Credit Karma updated it today. From the 3rd, it went up to 20 points. From the Christmas to the 3rd, it went up 20 points. And then it updated again on the 18th. And son, my joint went up again, another 20 points. Man, that's 40 points just this month alone. And then it's showing on my credit card. I maxed my credit card out. I went over my limit. First of all, if you go past 30%, they're going to give you a derogatory mark. I maxed my credit card out, especially after I got my filing on when you and Jimmy helped me in November. I got my filing and stuff after they sent my shit back 5 times. And I was like so elated. I was like, yo, I'm buying hella Louis Vuitton, everything for Christmas, right? So I'm gonna do an acceptable value. I got my stamps, everything. I was mad excited. But son, this is happening a little bit too fast for me, son. November, I get pulled over 3 times, cops let me off. Boom. I'm like, oh, this is crazy. Fine. Okay, on that side I'm covered. Then I'm messing on my credit card. I'm like, yo, I'm about to do this accepted for value. So, son, I maxed out my credit cards, bought hella Louis for everybody, my girl, my son, everything, Jordan, everything. Then I sent in a remittance right before Christmas because I knew I maxed everything out. Son, it hasn't even been a month. It's not the 25th yet. It hasn't even been a month. And they're already showing on my credit report already right now that it's paid, and I didn't even pay nothing this month? What?
Hey, it's because you've done everything right, and you stayed in honor, man. You've done everything right, and you stayed in honor. You know, it's not just, you know, the SPC paperwork. Yeah, that changes your status, but you still have to know how to stay in honor. You still got to know that contract law.
Wow. You a beast, nigga. You are a beast, bro. Let me tell you why. Because you're not staying on one subject. You're not just talking about the trust fund. It's not just about the trust fund. What about if you get hit with an offer on the commercial side or a charge from the constable on patrol? That's a whole other thing. You know what I'm saying? So it's like you're covering everything, bro. And you're letting everybody know they're gonna play with you. They're gonna play semantics with you. They're gonna do this. It's not gonna be easy. They're not just gonna. And they left my shit open too, son. Because under the instructions, I'm like, yo, I stamped it. I have mad different stamps, so I didn't stamp for closure and settlement. I just stamped acceptance for value and return for value. And gave them over the limit and instructed them to. I want my stuff open, and they kept the joint open. My credit card is still open, and it's showing paid on the credit card. I'm just waiting for the shit to bounce out the deal now.
No, it's all about the contracts, man. It's all about the contracts. I keep telling people contracts are dynamic. You can make a move. But I'll be honest with you, brother. I don't even use acceptor for value anymore because I don't have a need to. I behave like a creditor. You know what I mean? I don't go into any kind of debt. I behave like a creditor. Creditor writes the bills and so on and so forth.
Debt no more, so you don't gotta worry about putting.
So once I cleared everything out, I just stayed away from it, man. You know?
What?
I just stayed away from it.
The Most High wants us to do in the Bible. That's biblical.
Yeah. So I basically, you know, went to school. I did 7 years of school. I got an associate's in IT because I didn't know what I wanted to go to school for. And I was told, you know, what everybody else was told, to go to school and to get a good job and to do all that stuff. So, I mean, I tried that, you know, I went and I got my first associate's in IT, and then I hated it because I hated sitting behind a computer. And then so I switched to marketing, and then I ended up graduating with both those associates, and then I did a double bachelor's program at IUP for a bachelor's in HR and general management. And then I came out and then I found myself trying to look for jobs. And the only jobs that were around were like the mediocre ones. You know, they weren't very, very good and everything like that. And, you know, I found myself struggling, you know, and it was really hard. And, you know, and then I had very, very good credit. And, you know, I was trying to build a business online marketing. And the job that I had doing that, it wasn't very good. So I was using credit to do my ads and everything like that. And I ended up just blowing through a lot of credit trying to build my dreams and everything like that. And it put me in a position to where, you know, I was in a total of 120 grand in debts. You know, over 60 grand of that was in credit. So then I came to Jersey. I moved. I got a place on my own, and then I realized that I had to do something about my situation. And people were telling me that you know, I should file for bankruptcy and everything like that, and that I should just do it that way and just start over from scratch. And I knew for myself, you know, that wasn't an option. I couldn't do that because that wouldn't get me to where I wanted to be at. Like, I didn't want to have to file and then, you know, have to wait. And at that time, I didn't know nothing about law. I didn't know anything about credit. And so I moved to Jersey. And then the first time I came in contact with Taza Doc, I seen his videos on YouTube, just like probably all you. And I started watching them because I was looking for ways to get out of debt. And then from there, I realized that I started learning about stuff. And then I realized that the United States was bankrupt. And then I heard about the Secure Party Creditor. And the first one that ever told me about that was Taz, do his videos. You know, and I was looking all over YouTube, and I realized that this whole process of discharging debts and everything like that. And I'm like, well, how does this work? You know, and everything like that. And then so I realized from there what I had to do was fight through this. And I never filed any bankruptcy. I never did any of that. I just learned contracts. And Todd says all the time, you know, you have to know what makes a valid contract, you know, and a corporation cannot contract with a living man or woman. So they need you to become a corporation, a corporate entity. So, you know, I started really doing research on the whole process. And I didn't have, you know, a lot of funds back then, but I knew that I had to do the process. And so, you know, I made a lot of mistakes throughout my whole process. And it's like, you know, now, because I filed my secure party process like 2 years ago, 2018. And now I'm at the point that where, you know, I knew I had to get it done, but now I knew that I did some stuff wrong. And I always wanted to go with Taz for the process. But at the time I was like, I just got to get it done. But my mistake in that was, you know, trying to do something that's affordable is not always a good way. you know, sometimes you want to make sure things get done the right way and everything like that. So, I mean, even if you don't know how to discharge debts and everything like that, the main thing that you got to learn with this whole process is knowing contracts and knowing that the process of contract, if it's valid, you know, you have to know about the elements of a contract, the boxing, who it's addressed to, all that stuff that he talks about in his videos. And I've gotten so much value from all of his content that it's unbelievable. And some of the stuff, if you sit there and you study it, you could actually take certain parts of it and actually incorporate it into your affidavits. And when you do an affidavit, it stands as truth, right? So there's certain things that he says that nobody else will tell you, you know, certain things that nobody else even, it's uncommon knowledge. So, you know, you really have to take everything that you learn and really apply it. And that's the problem. Not everybody is serious about what they're doing. And when you're not serious about it, it's not something you can learn overnight. So you have to actually, you know, apply it and listen, you know, constantly and study constantly. You know, he talks about burning the midnight oil, you know, and basically that means hours and hours of studying and just listening. And like, I work in IT right now and I'm going through this whole process. And I was able to get rid of a lot of my debt just by knowing this stuff. And so when I'm sitting here working, I always have on audio and always listen. So sometimes I'm listening to his videos for 8 hours a day, just the videos, and I get on the calls and then you know everything like that. I've gotten a book from him and I'm gonna get more, and it's been amazing. You know, so anybody that's not taking this stuff serious, it's only gonna hurt you in the long run, because these contracts never stop. You know, they never stop, and you have to know how to handle them. You know, and at first I was scared. I was scared to send back a presentment in the mail. I was scared to, do it, because I thought something would happen to me. I thought they would come after me. I thought that, you know, I might get locked up if I just didn't pay something, or if I just didn't contract. I thought that they were going to come knocking at my door saying something. But that's what he talks about when he says that you have to be undaunted. You know, you can't be scared of words on a paper. And so this whole process has been very, very amazing for me, just the learning. I've been able to beat around 10 traffic situations. And, you know, a lot of the stuff he puts out, like conditional acceptances and everything like that, is very important, because you have to know how to respond in different situations. And with this upcoming webinar that he's doing on foreclosure, you know, your house is already paid when you sign the note, you know, and it produces a credit. And so if you know that the banks don't lend you anything, which it says in Modern Money Mechanics, and you're not a dead entity, you're a living soul, you know, you have to assert yourself in the contracts and everything like that. And you're not a dead entity, and this stuff is real. You could look up the fact of death in the Corpus Juris Secundum, section 16, page 892. It's a fact of death. So the tall man stuff, it's not a fiction. It's real. This stuff is real. The stuff that they've done to us. And you know, you have to really apply yourself to actually be able to maneuver in commerce, like he talks about, and is very important. So you know, you might not like his delivery or what he says to you, but not everybody's going to agree with him and not everybody's going to agree with you. So, you know, but everybody has, you know, their own beliefs, and everybody needs to respect how he, how he feels about certain topics and the stuff that he says to you, because it's very important for your life. This is your life. The contracts will never end. They continue. So, you know, you have to know how to deal with the certain situation when it comes and when it's applied to your life for yourself and your family. It's very, very important.
Hey, actually, Gio, tell them about the issue about the student, the alleged student loan, that large amount of supply that they told you was overdue and on immediately, and you told them that you was a creditor.
Okay, yes. Yeah, so basically, whenever I stopped, I actually I had a student loan. Student loan that was alleged. Hold on, I'm logging into my computer for a second. I had a student loan that was alleged, and I asked for the I had a student loan that was alleged. And I asked for the original instrument of indebtedness in its original form. That means the original contract that's not modified or anything like that. And they didn't have anything. They didn't have anything. And this is the case normally. Like normally they don't have the instrument. So I asked for the instrument. And what happened was they sent me back a document, which basically it had an electronic signature on there and all types of boxing. So I'm like, okay, this isn't even valid. So then I fought it because I learned contracts. And I asked them questions on the document itself. I asked them about the boxing, all that stuff. So then, you know, because of my situation, I got to a point to where I couldn't really pay on the student loan anymore. And I had to do something about it. And so I stopped paying, and then I wanted to test it out. So like sometimes I put myself in situations to actually be able to get myself out to see if I could actually have success with it. And it takes a lot of heart to be able to do that. And sometimes I like testing it out to see how it works. So I stopped paying on a student loan for like 6 months straight. And I would notice every single time that when they would take a payment, I took all the funds out of the account, right? And every single time that they would take a payment from the account, the bank account would go negative, but then it would credit the student loan account. So it was like they were getting payment, right? So then I would call up the bank and tell the bank that the transaction was unauthorized, right? So then they would reverse it, right? But then after like 6 months of doing that, they caught on to it, and so and so everything that was technically paid, pretty much it got reversed.
Right. So they hit you with an alleged debt for a total amount due.
Yeah.
Which
so
overdrew your account, right?
Then the bank account was over $1,000 negative. And the funny thing is, I actually found the email. I found the email before this call. So it actually, everything got reversed. And so I ended up writing a letter or an email to, because I was getting presentments from the bank saying that I owe this, everything like that. So I ended up writing them an email after I realized like who I was, that I'm the actual creditor, and I let them know my status and I asserted myself. And pretty much it was like 2 months I didn't hear anything. Then all of a sudden I got an email, and I never put anything in the account. Here was the email. It's $1,076. I don't know if you could see that.
Yeah, we can see that.
But it says cha-ching, you got money. And I was so excited, because it was like the first time that I've actually seen something. And it, to me, it was crazy. It was like, what happened? Like, it was from the fact that I asserted myself, and they did what I asked them to do. I asked them to balance out the account to zero. And two months later, I got that email out of nowhere. It hit my email because I had the bank account attached to it, and it was amazing. And I was like, wow, this stuff really works. And then another success that I have is with my gas and electric. I haven't paid a gas and electric bill in like a year, right? And they don't turn it off or nothing. You know, I ended up finding the contract, and then from there, somebody under the CFO contacted me on my cell phone, and pretty much. I asked them questions from what I learned from Taz and Law about the bankruptcy, everything like that. I did the handwritten letters, like he says to do. Asking the questions about the documents and actually, you know, about the debt. And telling them to do it under penalty of perjury. And so, you know, basically, I would handwrite them, and then now they don't bother me. Like, it's gone. Like, and it's so crazy that it actually does work. You know, if you apply yourself and you know what you're talking about, they're not just going to take anybody's word for it. They're gonna test you, and you have to know what you're talking about.
Can you hear me, Gio?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Let me ask you this. So you're saying, I don't think they get the clarity of what you're explaining here. So you're telling them that your account was overdrawn because they said that you owed that in student loans, and then you sent them a channel offer stating that you was a creditor. And you told them to zero out the account, and they
right.
did.
Right.
That's what he's actually sending you guys.
Yes, I sent them an email electronically to the ACH department.
Come on. As you come in the room, go ahead and give a thumbs up. We got 40-some people in the room. I don't know how many thumbs up we got here. And so the other things that you had success with, such as the electric and so on and so forth, do you think you would have actually had success if you didn't comprehend contract law?
No. And that's the majority of this whole thing. Beyond just discharging debt, you have to actually know contracts, and you have to know history. And that's why he goes into the history of things, because it's important to know the history in connection with the law, because you have to use them in conjunction with each other.
Wait, if you don't.
With the economy as it is, with the recession, it is highly probable that you're one of those people that's actually in need of becoming a secure party creditor. I will highly encourage you to click the link below this video right now and submit your donation to become a secure party creditor before it's too late. What are you waiting for? Now let's retract a bit. When you was born,
You were born a living, breathing, flesh, blood, being, and considered sovereign in a sovereign capacity. You were only subject to your mother and your father. And at that moment in time, then one of your parents entered into a contract by signing the live record of birth, which resulted into you being a ward of the state. You essentially became a commodity. Now, I know that sounds harsh, but this is just the truth. The state thereby gained power of attorney over you. This explains why entities and organizations such as Child Protective Services is able to come in and snatch the children away at their discretion without any parental interference. It just needs to be an alleged accusation of abuse. But if you really understand the law and if you really understand contracts, that it's actually illegal. This is why I encourage you to become a secure party creditor now. Click the link below this video and visit my website, www.truedisciplesofchrist.org, and order all the Taza Doc's books, Kahan Taza Doc Shah. This is a war on aphasia. This is an ideological war. This war is fought right here. And so as long as you suffer from aphasia, you will not be capable of effectively moving in this current society because everything is operated and controlled by commerce. 27 CFR 72.11 says all crimes are commercial. Knowing thus, it is imperative that you become a secure party creditor now. What are you waiting for? You waited long enough. Again, my name is Kahan Taza Doc Shah, a.k.a. the Deep Program Enlightener, a.k.a. a spokesman for men, a.k.a. your Ak, your brother. And with that, I'm going to say shalom, peace and blessings be upon you. Also, click the super thanks below this video and donate to fund this war on aphasia. I appreciate you watching. And it is my prayer that this cleared up exactly what a secure party creditor is and why it's essential that you become a secure party creditor now. Stop waiting, stop delaying, and get it done now. Shalom. Peace. Two fingers.